And as I say, there are three options on the table. We've given an initial view, and I would encourage everybody to respond.
Thank you. That is topical questions. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 14375 in the name of Stuart Stevenson on the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament Amendment Bill. Members who wish to take part in this debate should press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Stuart Stevenson to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. 9 minutes, Mr Stevenson.
Presiding Officer, back in April this year, the Parliament agreed to the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee's proposal for a committee bill to amend the Members' Interest Act. The bill and its accompanying documents were introduced on the 27th of May. I'm very pleased to return to the Chamber today to invite the Parliament to agree to the general principles of this committee bill. Accordingly, I move motion number S4M14375 in my name. The overall aim of the bill is to amend the Interests Act to ensure that information about MSPs' financial interests is transparent and accessible. The bill combines two existing reporting processes to assist MSPs in complying with requirements to report donations. The proposals in the bill would also strengthen the sanctions available to Parliament to deal with any breaches to the rules set out in the Interests Act, widen the scope of the offence of paid advocacy, and extend the length of time that the Parliament may retain members' registers of interest. I will speak in my closing remarks about this aspect of the bill later this afternoon. Turning first to the proposals to eliminate dual reporting. MSPs currently have to report financial interests in two places: to the Electoral Commission under the Political Parties Elections and Referendums Act, otherwise known as PEPERA, and to the Parliament. There is an overlap between the two regimes, which results in the dual reporting of certain financial interests. The bill before us today makes the necessary changes to the Parliament's register so that dual reporting can be ended, bringing the reporting requirements into a single place for MSPs. This would make information about MSPs' financial interests more easily available to the public, and it will be beneficial for a number of other reasons. Information on MSPs' financial interests could be found in a single place, on the Parliament's website, where you would expect to find it. MSPs would only have to register in one place and can now receive advice on all their interests from parliamentary officials, the clerks to the committee. In addition, all complaints about an MSP not meeting the reporting requirements would be dealt with in a single way. They'd be dealt with in future by the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland. This will make the process easier to navigate for the public, for MSPs, and with anyone with any interest whatsoever in the process. A single process for all MSPs, for all complaints, for all compliance. The approach in the bill has been to leave the Parliament's existing regime as undisturbed as possible, while incorporating the donations and transactions that are currently reportable under PEPERA. However, the changes included in the bill to bring the two regimes together in one place do make the Interests Act much more complex. The bill adjusts the definition of gifts and the definition of overseas visits, and a new category has been added for loans and certain other transactions. The bill also adds an additional layer of rules on the aggregation of interests with a combined value of over £1,500. The overall approach has been to limit the changes we propose, wherever possible, to interests with a single or combined value in excess of the £1,500 threshold, which has come originally from the PEPERA. The current framework for ending dual reporting in the Electoral Administration Act of 2006 does not extend to independent MSPs. As that Act stands, dual reporting can only be ended for members of registered political parties and not for independent members. The bill we'll be debating today contains an amendment to that Act which will allow dual reporting to be ended for all MSPs. The committee has included this provision in the bill so that all MSPs are treated in the same way, and I know that this is something that the presiding officer herself feels very strongly about. And as the convener of the SPPA committee, I've talked to all those in the current parliament who might be affected, and indeed my last meeting with the late Margaret MacDonald MSP a month before she died, when I visited her at home, was precisely to discuss the effect of what we are proposing today with her, as with all other members. And I may say she was in remarkably good spirit, and my 3 minutes on this subject extended to a full hour while we discussed current political topics. No surprise there whatsoever. It would be unfair if independent members were required to continue with dual reporting when the system had been streamlined for MSPs who are members of political parties. Let me now address the changes to sanctions that are also included in the bill. The Scotland Act 2012 introduced changes to Section 39 of the Scotland Act 1998 to give the Parliament greater flexibility in determining what sanctions are appropriate for breaches of the members' interest regime and the paid advocacy prohibition. Our bill largely restates the existing criminal offence. The provisions on parliamentary sanctions in the Interests Act are currently limited to excluding a member from proceedings in the Parliament or restricting participation in proceedings on matters in relation to which there has been a breach. The bill makes clear that a full range of parliamentary sanctions will be available if an MSP fails to register or declare an interest or undertakes paid advocacy. It includes a provision for a range of parliamentary sanctions that are broadly equivalent to some of the measures that are available to the Parliament where it withdraws a member's rights and privileges, for example, in respect of a breach of the Code of Conduct. This approach ensures consistency with Section 39, which envisages further provision on sanctions being made in or under an Act of the Scottish Parliament. The committee believes that it is vital that a wide range of sanctions is available to the Parliament for dealing with breaches of the Interests Act and the Code of Conduct. Sanctions available to Parliament must be sufficiently stringent for it to respond effectively to breaches of the rules and to discourage such breaches in the first place. The bill ensures that a broad range of sanctions is available to the Parliament, including potentially removing all allowances or salary. This change demonstrates that the Parliament has the tools to deal effectively with any breaches to the Interests Act. Paid advocacy is where an individual uses their position as an MSP to advocate a particular matter in return for payment, including benefit in kind, or to urge any other MSP to do so. It's a criminal offence and a breach of the Interests Act for an MSP to undertake paid advocacy, but no MSP has ever been found to breach these rules. The committee is very clear, given the gravity with which paid advocacy should be treated, that the criminal offence for paid advocacy is appropriate. Our consultation paper proposed the definition should be amended for greater consistency with the Bribery Act 2010. Particular note to the committee was the incorporation of the act of agreeing to receive inducements within the offence of being bribed under Section 2 of the Bribery Act. The paid advocacy offence currently requires actual receipt. It does not incorporate payments or benefits in kind that a member agrees to receive. Our bill amends the definition of paid advocacy, so by agreeing to receive inducements as well as actually receiving them, there would be an offence. It would be a breach of the Act. The bill introduces a new sanction that the Parliament should be able to agree a motion of censure. I will speak more about this in my closing remarks. I believe the provisions of this bill will increase transparency for the public, make it easier for members to ensure that they comply with the rules, and create a more robust standards regime. Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. And I now call on Joe Fitzpatrick, Minister. 6 minutes, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, when Parliament debated the committee report back in April, we talked about how implementation of the Scotland Act 2012 had paved the way for the committee to update the members' interest statute in full. And I won't miss today's opportunity to once again stress the importance and benefits of this Parliament being responsible for all matters relevant to its internal operations. And that's not just a matter of ownership. It's the realisation that the Scottish public would quite reasonably expect the Parliament to be responsible for its internal affairs. It also helps to reinforce the accountability of the Parliament to the people of Scotland. It's only right that the rules under which we as members operate are wholly conceived in this Parliament, and that this Parliament can be wholly judged on the robustness and the framework it chooses to put in place. So I therefore welcome the bill promoted by the committee to amend the existing members' interest statute. More generally, I want to reflect, if I may, on the fact that these measures are brought forward by a committee bill. In total, there have been 6 previous committee bills since devolution, 3 in session 1, 1 in session 2, and 2 in session 3. And like this one, most have been parliamentary in nature. So these are not things that come around every week, and I would just like to take the opportunity to reaffirm the government's support for the ability of committees to bring forward legislative proposals. That arrangement helps to characterise a modern, healthy and proactive legislature. The government would therefore encourage committees to consider proposals that might be suitable for promotion via the committee bill process. And I once again want to put on record the government's recognition that the bill subject matter is clearly parliamentary in nature. The government does, however, wish to offer its views on the proposals in their current form. I want to commend the committee on the suite of reform proposals contained in the bill. The bill delivers, I think, on 3 fronts. Firstly, it seeks to establish measures to enhance members' accountability to the public, reflecting the latest views as to what constitutes appropriate probity standards. Secondly, it looks to standardise arrangements for reporting interests and streamlining the activity required of members and offers the public a single point of reference. And thirdly, it offers the Parliament flexibility in the event that circumstances ever arise that necessitate enforcement activity. And I consider each of these elements to be significant in themselves. But to seek to deliver them in a joined-up approach via this bill demonstrates the committee's level of ambition and commitment to reform, and I think, as a committee, should be commended in their approach. Turning to the specific reforms the bill seeks to implement, the reduction in the financial threshold for registering gifts from 1% to 0.5% of a member's salary clearly enhances transparency, and I welcome the committee's consideration of the report published by the Group of States Against Corruption, which promoted a reduction to the registration threshold. I note moves across legislatures and assemblies in the UK to reduce the gift threshold, and I think it's appropriate for our Parliament to have the opportunity to keep in step with such changes. The backbone of the bill, as the convener said, is the aim to end dual reporting of members' financial interests to both the Parliament and the Electoral Commission, a move that is, I see, supported by the Electoral Commission. The government notes the bill is tackling the complex interaction of the current members' interest regime with the regime on reporting donations and loans under the Political Parties, Elections and Referendums Act. And the government supports the principle that dual reporting should end. The creation of a single reporting regime will be beneficial in terms of transparency and more generally improve governance in Scotland. It's right to ensure that elected members have a clear and unambiguous system for registering their interests. And it is also right that such improvements can equally benefit the public in terms of reviewing those interests and in seeking assurances over the integrity of the registration scheme. Commend the committee, its clerking team and the Electoral Commission for tackling this topic and delivering a clear reform proposal for the Parliament's consideration. The last policy strand in the bill I want to offer some comment on is the proposal that the Parliament be given full flexibility over imposition of sanctions in respect of the members' interest regime. Government sees this sees merit in such a move, and it would allow the Parliament to consider any breach on its merits and to apply whatever sanctions it deemed appropriate in respect to that breach. The current situation, whereby the only sanction available to Parliament is to exclude a member, could be viewed as disproportionate in certain cases. The ability of a proportionate sanction could ultimately encourage more enforcement action. The proposal to add a new sanction for the Parliament to agree a motion of censure also seems sensible in that regard. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Government welcomes the commitment shown from the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee to reviewing and updating the current members' interest legislation. The benefits of conducting that review in the context of the wider competence has, I believe, shone through in terms of the significance and helpful reforms now proposed in the Bill. And it should not surprise the Chamber that the Government welcomes and supports the Committee Bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Margaret McDougall, 4 minutes or so, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to open this debate for the Labour benches, having been a member of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee whilst they consulted on the changes to the way that members register outside interests, gifts and political donations that are proposed in this bill. This is a technical bill, which comes from this Parliament being given greater flexibility over the scheme for registering members' interests by the provisions of the Scotland Act 2012. Members of the public want assurances that elected representatives are working in their interests, and the Register of Interests is an important tool in holding members in this chamber to account on this. The system we have must hold the confidence of the public that MSPs' activities are not being influenced by outside financial interests and that they are transparent and open. This bill contains significant amendments to the current system, which strengthens it and will lead to greater confidence in it. Whilst the threshold for registering a financial interest will remain the same, we welcome the important change to how we, as members, will report any financial interests and how members of the public will be able to access it. The current system of reporting financial interests to both the Electoral Commission and this Parliament not only means more administrative duties for members, but it also means financial interests are recorded in two places. We welcome the Bill's proposal to end this dual reporting for two reasons. Whilst members will still be required to register any financial interests within the existing financial thresholds, moving to a system of one report to this Parliament, made within the current 30 days limit set by the Electoral Commission, will streamline the registration scheme for members and make it easier for us to comply with the requirements set. It will also give members of the public one platform to seek the information about members' interests that they wish to access, producing a more efficient system. We also welcome the proposal to create a more robust enforcement and sanction regime that I am sure will increase the public's confidence in our Register of Interest system. I believe it is absolutely correct that a full range of sanctions for registration breaches should be available. The current system of Parliament having the right to withdraw a member's rights and privileges over a registration breach is too limited in scope and cannot be an appropriate response in all cases. I believe there must be a range of options open to Parliament which are able to cover cases of minor breaches, but also in more serious cases. We as members should also welcome moves to have the Standard Commissioner investigate all breaches. Currently, some breaches are investigated by both the Commissioner and the Electoral Commission, and the Bill's proposal simplifies this. This change also allows the Procurator Fiscal to investigate all breaches where currently some minor breaches can be pursued on a civil rather than a criminal basis. That takes me to the committee's decision to retain the criminal offence part of the existing system. This is absolutely the right decision for a system that must hold the confidence of the public. It would be wrong for us in this Parliament to be seen to be taking breaches of the Register of Interest less seriously, and I fully support the retention of this in the committee's bill. We also welcome other proposals in the bill, such as the enactment of the recommendations made by the Group of States Against Corruption by lowering the threshold of registering gifts to 0.5% of a member's salary. And we wholeheartedly give our support to the proposed ban on paid advocacy. Members in this Parliament are here to represent constituents in our constituencies and regions. Members should not be paid to advocate causes on behalf of outside organisations, and this bill makes important changes to this. Members are often lobbied by groups and the current system is not transparent. Whilst we wait for the government to bring forward the lobbying bill, which will hopefully meet the aims of the private members' bill proposed by my colleague Neil Findlay, the bill today proposes a significant amendment to the definition of paid advocacy. This bill will make it an offence for members of this Parliament to agree to receive financial inducement for advocacy work. This is a significant change from the current definition, whereby only receiving money for advocacy work is an offence. With this change, we are sending a clear message that accepting paid advocacy work is not acceptable conduct for any member of this Parliament, and we welcome the strengthened definition of paid advocacy. Presiding Officer, we on these benches are pleased to support the proposals within the committee's bill.
Many thanks, and I now call on John Scott. 4 minutes or so, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I am pleased to speak in support of the bill before us today too. I pay tribute to Stuart Stevenson in his role as Convener of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. He has coordinated a considerable amount of work of the preparatory work that has been required to bring the bill to this stage, as well as introducing it on behalf of the committee today. I would also like to offer my appreciation to some of the others who laid the groundwork for this bill's introduction. And in this instance, it is appropriate to consider the extensive cooperation between our Parliament's officials and the Electoral Commission to create compatibility between their respective registers of interest. We thank them for their efforts in handling what the committee has recognised are complex areas of law and administration. This work will enable the ending of dual reporting and its replacement with a single register, as envisaged by the 2006 Electoral Administration Act. This will hopefully provide clarity, not just in reporting terms, but in making information convenient and straightforward for the public to access. On this side of the chamber, we also take note of the Council of Europe's GRECO recommendations on gifts. We believe they have been well accommodated in the bill. This follows similar actions being taken in the House of Commons and House of Lords in light of the 2013 GRECO report on the UK. The committee has also examined the guidance available to members on gifts in light of that report to ensure that it is clear and compliant. And it was the committee's conclusion that this area is already well covered by the information that is provided. The UK has been an active member of the GRECO since 1999. And it is right that it continues to be an effective forum for evaluating our efforts in preventing corruption and ensuring public sector transparency. We are also supportive of ensuring that the legislative framework underpinning the Interests Act is sufficiently robust. While it is positive to see that no members have been convicted of offences in this area, a record we undoubtedly hope to maintain, it is important that we have rigorous measures in place to accommodate all circumstances and be able to deal with them appropriately. It is sensible that the prohibition of paid advocacy is extended to better mirror the offence of bribery as put in place across the United Kingdom by the 2010 Bribery Act, itself the consequence of examination both at home and in light of our anti-corruption work internationally. In both circumstances, it is clearly justifiable the requirements of the offence relate to agreement to receive an inducement rather than the actual receipt of an inducement being necessary. In December last year, the UK government published its wide-ranging UK anti-corruption plan. While the UK has always been seen as amongst the least corrupt nations in the world, this plan made it clear that there is more to do, and we have seen our international anti-corruption rankings improve as a consequence of our willingness to make sensible changes to our laws and practice. This Parliament should be mindful of its responsibilities and the direction of travel under that plan. The provisions of this bill will form a substantial part of our response. This bill has undergone detailed consideration before the committee. It has been clear from those deliberations and from the responses to the consultation that its contents are sensible and reasonable proposals to ensure this Parliament remains transparent while providing us with the tools to address situations where we fall short of the standards that may be expected. Thank you.
Many thanks. I have one request in the open debate, so I now call Tavish Scott. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I just wanted to really make two or three points on this bill. The first is to recognise the committee and the convener's role in that and in bringing forward these proposals. It is important to recognise what has not happened since 1999, as the convener and one or two other members mentioned, and that is there have been no breaches of this in any sense, and therefore the tightening up of it has to be seen in that context. We are tightening up a measure that has in large part worked, and that, as far as I've always been aware, the understanding that members across the political parties and across the chamber have in terms of the responsibilities, both in terms of reporting, has been, with one or two slight edges in terms of timescale, been complied with at all times. What has come to light has been the point that the convener made in his opening remarks, and that is the dual reporting. And this tightens up and deals with that, and not before time. Some of us have been caught by that. It's no one's fault. It's just, as far as I can see, one of those things that needed to shake out during the context of alterations to perfectly sensible proposals. But in at least resolving that matter, this bill creates, as it were, a one-stop shop, which I think is eminently sensible in terms of the procedures of this Parliament in upholding the standards. It did strike me, just two final points, it did strike me, I say this gently to the Minister, it did strike me that we should apply the same principles as we do to ministers as well as to members. I'm sure he would wish to point out that ministers have to comply to even higher standards in terms of financial transparency, but certainly that would be very important indeed that that were the case. And finally, and I might just address this two final questions, if I may, to the convener to deal with in his winding up, and I may just not have seen the detail on this. It is by definition wrong and an offence that any member were to be offered money in relation to paid advocacy. But the similar question would also apply were someone be so stupid as to actually ask for it, and he may wish to clarify that in his... I'm sure that's something that the lawyers, if no one else, have given some thought to. And the final point actually did strike me when he was speaking, and that is about not just donations. He rightly set out the limit that all members now will comply with in terms of the donation limit in this, in terms of the register. But, of course, donations don't just come from individuals to an individual politician. They also come through political parties. And he might want to address whether this register deals with the fact that much money that flows into politics flows into political parties and then is spent in regions and constituencies of Scotland. And I don't know, I genuinely don't know whether this bill does anything about that in terms of transparency whatsoever.
Many thanks. And following that short debate, we now turn to the closing speeches, and I call on John Scott. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And this has been a welcome debate. And in a democracy, it's right that there is proper scrutiny when representatives are, in essence, deliberating on how best to regulate themselves and their conduct. Given the justifiable public interest in transparency, I'm pleased to see that the proposals of this bill will serve to enhance how this Parliament operates. As has been touched upon, this has been a lengthy process. The end of dual reporting was envisaged in the Electoral Administration Act 2006 and was removed from the House of Commons in 2009. It was in spring 2013 that the consultation was opened for the bill before us now. That consultation highlighted some of the benefits which members have brought forward in their speeches today. The Commissioners for Standards and Public Life, for example, pointed to the significance of the reporting changes not only in terms of simplifying the regulatory framework, but for the purposes of public transparency too. In its evidence, the Electoral Reform Society used the opportunity to call for a full review of all procedures in this Parliament to take place. While it envisaged such a review before any legislation on the content of this bill was brought forward, a proposition which must have seen as unlikely, it is something perhaps worthy of consideration for the future. We sometimes forget that this Parliament is still a young institution, although perhaps no longer a fledgling institution, and it would be no bad thing for us to examine how it has evolved from what was envisaged at the outset. The ERS report, we go back to our founding principles. I beg your pardon. The ERS proposes we go back to our founding principles and the reports of the consultative steering group to consider holistically where we are and what the effects have been of our reforms. It's also important as this Parliament is evolving. Earlier this year, we saw Scotland's first tax levied since 1707. Income tax will follow next year, with the extensive powers of the Scotland Bill being on the near horizon. In any case, and at the risk of labouring the points in my opening speech about the process of bringing this bill forward, I would like to make a further observation. And it is extremely positive that this Parliament is moving forward to make changes to its standards and privileges in a way that is as consensual as possible. Presiding Officer, this bill contains a number of sensible measures that will provide how we operate and improve how we operate and hopefully ensure that this Parliament is seen as an open, transparent and responsible institution in the future. I hope that the proposals brought forward today will go some way towards satisfying those principles. And in closing, I would again like to state my appreciation for the work of Stuart Stevenson, his fellow committee members and the officials, all of whom are laying the extensive groundwork that this bill required. I am pleased to say that we will be gaining the support of this side of the chamber. Thank you very much.
Many thanks. And I now call on Mary Fee. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by thanking Stuart Stevenson and the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee and the clerks for the work they have done to progress this important piece of legislation. And I'm pleased that across the chamber we all agree that we need robust, accountable and transparent mechanisms for reporting members' interests. And this is a Parliament that rightly prides itself on openness and accountability. And this bill gives Parliament the opportunity to revisit the legislation surrounding members' interests. And whilst the committee considered the regime to be robust, we must maintain standards to ensure sufficient checks and balances exist. And this bill will help increase transparency and accessibility to information about members' financial interests and will ensure that Parliament has a robust set of sanctions to deal with any breaches to its rules. And Stuart Stevenson spoke of the provision which will create a new sanction, allowing Parliament to agree a motion of censure. A motion of censure will serve as a useful middle ground if a member is found to be in breach of the rules, but that breach is not serious enough to justify removal of parliamentary privilege. A motion of censure would allow debate and would give the member in question the opportunity to explain the breach and apologise. Another useful change is the length of time information on members' interests will be kept. The committee considered it more appropriate to keep register entries for 10 years instead of 5, and there are a number of practical reasons for doing this. It will assist members in ensuring information about their previously held interests are available at the start of a session. And similarly, if a member is not returned to Parliament but does return at a subsequent election, it is easier to check the previous interests that were recorded. The change will also increase transparency in relation to members' interests, as the information will be easily accessible to the public for much longer. And these changes, combined with the changes to the register, provide an additional layer of transparency to the public seeking to access members' registers. Ending dual reporting is an important step. At the moment, the information is on both the Parliament's website and the Electoral Commission, depending on the nature of the interest. And streamlining this process will assist people in accessing information, but will also help members to comply with the regime. And with regards to paid advocacy, whilst I am pleased that no member has found to be in breach of these rules, we must, however, keep these rules under review, and I think it's right we are strengthening the rules on paid advocacy through this bill. Most members of the public would expect there to be a breach where the member has agreed to undertake paid advocacy, even where cash has not changed hands. And this bill ensures that this behaviour will be caught. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I am pleased to close the debate for Scottish Labour and support the motion seeking the Parliament's agreement on the general principles of this committee bill. Its provisions will increase transparency and strengthen the standard regime in the Scottish Parliament. Openness, transparency and accountability must be at the forefront of the way this Parliament operates, and I am happy to support the motion in Stuart Stevenson's name. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call on Joe Fitzpatrick. 5 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Margaret McDougall referred to this bill as being a very technical bill, and she's right. It is a very technical bill, and I think I earlier put on record my thanks to the committee for the work and their clerks for the work they've done to bring forward such a technical bill in the way that they have done. But I hope that today's debate has made it a little bit less technical for anyone that's listening in, anyone that's reading the report, can actually understand what this very technical bill is about and what we're hoping to do. And it's good to hear that we have cross-party support for the proposals that the committee is bringing forward. The measures in the bill send out a strong message on Parliament's commitment to a modern and flexible approach to the registration system that can deliver benefits for the Parliament, its members and the public. I think in dealing with the point that Tavish Scott made, I think he's absolutely right that we need to make sure that we are all subject to the same high standards, and that goes for ministers and members in equal measure. And I think we've got a pretty good record across the years, going back to 1999, of having those robust procedures in place, and we need to, I agree, keep making sure that we keep that standard as high as we can, and that's partly what this bill does. No doubt the committee will appreciate the constructive comments from across the chamber. The proposals to end dual reporting is, I think, a significant step forward. I commend the committee for its commitment to that move and the benefits it should deliver for both members and the public. And I think in terms of tackling the specific issue of independent members, that might have been something that it might just have been easier not to do. But I think we're all grateful that you took the time to try and bring forward a bill which tackles that, I think, appropriately and to everyone's benefit. The bill demonstrates that the committee is alert to the importance of transparency in public affairs, and it's very much aware of the outward-facing nature of the members' interest bill. The reforms also demonstrate how the Parliament can make better use as greater competence come towards it. The competence offered in this area under the original devolution settlement was unnecessarily constraining in comparison. Why, for example, were limitations ever placed on the type of sanctions this Parliament could impose in response to non-compliance? The new arrangements proposed by the committee, now that such barriers have been removed, is better, particularly in terms of flexibility of the order. And I think it gives future sanctions are actually more likely to be imposed when there is a more proportionate sanction rather than the nuclear option, as is all that exists just now. It's, I think, important that our Parliament is continuously seen as willing to deliver tangible improvements in its operation, in this case building upon the robust members' interest system already in place. These proposals seek to further enhance measures that play a key role in ensuring that Scotland has confidence in its MSPs and in its Parliament. It's in our collective interest to ensure that the public considers that their MSPs are meeting the highest possible standards of probability, and we undertake our parliamentary duties. Measures which, above all, ensure that the electorate will be left in no doubt that their elected representatives act on their behalf and in their interests. Building that public confidence and ultimately trust will help to reinforce Parliament's integrity. It represents an important further development of this Parliament. As the Scottish Parliament grows in stature, so does public expectation. The Scottish Parliament was founded on transparency, cooperation and inclusivity for all the people of Scotland, and the measures before us today help support and reinforce those principles. Thank you.
Many thanks. And can I now call on Stuart Stevenson to wind up the debate on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We as a Parliament pride ourselves on openness and accountability in relation to the behaviour of all our MSPs. The question, of course, is could we do more? to build public trust and make sure we have a regime that is fit for purpose, because robust standards are essential to ensure that should wrongdoing occur, there are sufficient checks and balances to hold MSPs to account. And this bill seeks to increase transparency and accessibility. These are important matters, and the Parliament must always be keeping these under review and make improvements where the opportunity arises. And let me take this opportunity to thank Parliament for the establishment of a committee to take this bill forward, provided that is it receives the support of members at 5 o'clock tonight. And I thank those who participated in the debate for their engagement in what is an important topic for our future probity and reputation. Turning to a few of the things that have been raised in the debate, the Minister mentioned the reduction in gifts from 1% to 0.5%. That's a subject we first discussed in committee on the 10th of October 2013. That stems, of course, from the Group d'État contre la corruption, which is something that we are following. The Minister also referred to the Electoral Commission, and we've helpfully got a briefing from the Electoral Commission that makes clear that they are satisfied with what we're doing, in particular that the Electoral Commission will be able to obtain the necessary information that they require from the standards clerks in this place to meet their future publication compliance and enforcement options. Tavish Scott, I particularly welcome his coming along and bringing his considerable experience to bear on this subject, and I'll just pick up a couple of the points that he made. I think the Minister has already indicated that ministers are caught by this, and I was going to make that point, that certainly in respect of their behaviour as MSPs. The interesting point that was made by Tavish Scott in relation to soliciting rewards, in Section 9 of the bill that's before us, we introduce the phrase, or agreeing to receive. It's certainly our intention that that would catch soliciting, but I will take further advice from the clerks to see if any further amendments that might just make beyond misapprehension that quite clear, because it's quite clear that soliciting would be as unacceptable to any of us as agreeing to receive. In relation to political parties funding members' activities in their constituencies and elsewhere, we're seeking to catch the whole issue of funding of political activities by members by some of the amendments we have. But largely, and in particular in relation to elections, the Electoral Commission already catch that activity in the reporting that political parties require to make to them, and which are, of course, published on the website. And, of course, equally, we do make reference to the period of election, when, of course, electoral returns, financial returns have to be made, and make some provision for when money that's solicited for that purpose is not spent within the 35 days of the motion. Now, I want to just pick up of the election. I want to just pick up one or two other points that have arisen and that I perhaps can say a little bit more about. First of which, I promised I'd say a little bit about motion of censure. It would serve as a useful middle ground where the Standards Committee found a member to be in breach, but where we did not consider the breach to be sufficiently serious to justify a sanction such as exclusion or removal of other parliamentary privileges. Now, such a motion could be debated, providing the MSP, who's the subject of the motion, with a public opportunity to apologise in person. I believe a motion of censure would be a useful addition to the Parliament's toolkits of sanctions. I also mentioned the bill's provisions for retention of members' registers, and we've already heard from Mary Fee a great deal about that. I think keeping the register for 10 years as distinct from the current 5 is going to be particularly useful in general, but specifically where people have what you might term broken service and come back. There are also practical reasons in that it just helps members see what they had previously said, and it will increase transparency overall. The current timescale of 5 years was previously just set relation to the period when people were elected, but of course it's reasonable to extend it. Additional transparency for the public has got to be good news, and keeping it for longer helps that, letting the public see what's going on. Now, at the moment, all the information that we're referring to is on the Parliament's website, but also held by the Electoral Commission, depending on the nature of the interest. But this bill will mean that people much more readily can come to one place, but it'll also help members to comply with the two regimes. I think most of us have comparatively modest operations that involve the Electoral Commission in this respect, but when it occurs, it will be something we're unfamiliar with, and we don't have sources of advice in the Parliament. This changes. And in paid advocacy, I repeat once again, as others have, we've never seen these rules breached, and the changes that we want to make today are important in signalling to everyone how important we regard these as. But at the end of the day, it is down to the personal probity of each and every one of us, not merely the rules that appear in the book. The provisions in the bill are going to make sure that we are in both places, and that's a comfortable place to be. Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to be able to close this debate. I'm delighted that we've had the opportunity to take this bill forward through stage one. I reconfirm that I look for the Parliament's agreement and the general principles of this committee bill. I hope, as the Minister suggests, that we might see a greater number of committee bills in future sessions, not all simply related to our internal business. But this is an important bill, increases transparency, ensures our procedures remain robust. Presiding Officer.
Many thanks, Convener. That concludes the debate on stage one of the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament Amendment Bill. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, and I'll allow a few seconds for members to change seats. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 14403 in the name of Paul Wheelhouse on progress on implementing recommendations of the expert review group in new psychoactive substances. Could I invite members who wish to speak in this debate to press the request to speak buttons now, please? And I call on Paul Wheelhouse to speak to and move the motion. Minister, 13 minutes or so, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am grateful for the opportunity to open this debate today on a subject in which there is continued interest from members. New psychoactive substances present a serious challenge to drug services, to clinicians, enforcement agencies, and those managing their physical, emotional, and often devastating impact on our communities. As many members have often reflected, these new substances are often misleadingly referred to as legal highs. The term legal high is an unhelpful term, and just because a substance is advertised as legal, in one respect at least, it does not mean it is safe for human consumption. Whether a substance is banned or not, when it comes to NPS, it's impossible to know a product's content and the dangers it may pose. New psychoactive substances, or NPS, are substances whose sale is not restricted, perhaps because the product is passed off as a bath salt, say, but are substances which mimic, if taken by an individual, the effects of controlled drugs and can be just as harmful. Indeed, we know they are already having fatal consequences. Deaths where NPS were found to be present in the body have risen from 4 in 2009 to 114 in 2015, although I should stress that's not necessarily the only cause of the death of the individual and not necessarily the main cause either. But we have yet, perhaps, to see the peak in the numbers. I'm sure many of you will agree that the biggest difficulty and perhaps frustration is that the existing legislative framework enables these substances to remain legal, albeit for an alternative use, and that they do not come under the traditional radar of the Misuse of Drugs Act, on which we have relied to control drugs. That is why, at the request of my predecessor, the Scottish Government formed an expert review group in August 2014. The membership of the group was drawn from a range of expertise from legal, policy and operational backgrounds, and I presented its report to the Chamber on the 26th of February this year, and I'm grateful to members for their contribution to the debate on that occasion. They had a deliberate and specific legal focus, but also considered operational and practical aspects in the context of the existing legal framework. The group presented its report to me on that day in February and made six recommendations on how the existing legal framework might be strengthened, not just in the current law, but how it can be made to work better in practice. And I'm pleased today to be able to update the Chamber on the progress we're making to respond to the recommendations made. One of the reasons for the popularity of NPS is their seemingly legitimate status. They are sold openly in our communities on our high streets, which is not acceptable. Some head shops are highly visible to school pupils travelling to and from school. And the expert review group recognised this and, combined with a range of evidence, made a specific recommendation that the Scottish Government work with the UK Government on new legislation to address the challenge posed by head shops. We welcome the progress to bring NPS under legal control and are working closely with the UK Government on the detail of how the Psychoactive Substances Bill can work in the best interest of Scotland and work effectively within Scotland's legal framework and courts. The bill as drafted does not yet fully reflect the distinct and specific criminal and civil procedures adopted in Scottish courts, and my officials have been working with the Home Office to ensure that the bill can be implemented effectively in Scotland. I will shortly be meeting Mike Penning MP, the Home Office Minister, responsible for the legislation, and making sure that he receives our support in making the legislation effective. The bill, as proposed by the Home Office, creates new criminal offences to produce, supply, offer to supply, possess, with intent to supply, import and export psychoactive substances. It will proceed through the various parliamentary stages and, subject to parliamentary approval, will come into force in April 2016. I am also pleased to inform members that through representations made, the Scottish Government, Police Scotland and the Crown Office have been invited to be part of a UK-wide implementation group to support implementation. This bill will be where much of the practical work will be done to develop guidance for the police and other agencies to support successful prosecutions. I am further reassured by plans agreed with the Home Office that a specific Scottish workshop will be held in February next year to hear directly from those who will be enforcing the law and preparing for the changes. I know that many members will be reassured that in future those who seek to sell NPS in the knowledge of the harms they cause will face the full legal consequences of their actions. Experience from the Republic of Ireland, where a similar law has already been introduced, suggests that head shops have closed and NPS is less visible. However, we need to be alert to the possibility that other distribution channels will become dominant, such as the internet, and there may be only limited scope to control these, for example, banning NPS sales via UK domain names. The expert group recommended that work be progressed to develop a common definition of NPS to guide both enforcement agencies and treatment agencies, recognising that this may need to vary. Further work was also suggested in relation to data sharing and managing the flow of information about prevalence and harms between agencies. In this regard, the Scottish Government has been engaging with Scottish stakeholders, culminating in the publishing of a questionnaire on the 23rd of September. This enables a structured conversation with the sector that can inform our discussions with the Home Office and guide our own response to the needs of those in Scotland in respect of information sharing and a common definition. A further area being explored is the potential forensic capability that will be required by the proposed law, that of testing a substance for its psychoactivity. When I meet the Home Office, I will be pressing for a collaborative approach to creating the forensic capacity to equip us to implement the legislation and manage people in treatment in an effective way. This will go some way to developing the Forensic Centre for Excellence that the expert group recommended, and we are supporting the Scottish Police Authority to consider how it might build capacity in this regard. This work sits alongside some specific research that's now been commissioned into the prevalence and harms of NPS, and that work was recently awarded to a partnership between the University of Glasgow and the Scottish Drugs Forum. It is expected that the findings will be available in May of next year. The expert review group acknowledged the requirement to support trading standard services, which are considering NPS enforcement action against people selling NPS in our high streets, and to assist in removing any inconsistencies in approach across local authorities and helping to see wider adoption of good practice. One of the recommendations was to develop a toolkit and operational guidance with the appropriate stakeholders to assist trading standard staff to tackle NPS, learning from experiences in areas such as Angus and South Ayrshire, among others. Following this recommendation, an NPS strategic working group was formed by COSLA, Trading Standards Scotland and partners to progress this work to develop guidance that will be a vital tool for trading standards staff on the front line. I was delighted to launch the guidance on the 15th of September, and this trading standards guidance will go a long way to protecting the people of Scotland between now and the introduction of the new legislation. It will ensure that trading standards staff across Scotland are better equipped to remove some of the current barriers in tackling NPS at a practical level. The guidance focuses on the application of consumer protection legislation to NPS, and in particular the legal rules controlling the sale and supply of unsafe products. It was created in the absence of a bespoke legislative response so far, and there will be a need to test and shape the guidance based on what works in practice. In particular, though, it acknowledges that the best way to protect local communities from the blight of NPS is to work in partnership with Police Scotland and NHS colleagues. Another of the expert review groups... I will, certainly.
John Finney.
Thank you, President Officer. I'm grateful for the Minister taking intervention on that point. I'm disappointed that 7 minutes into your speech, Minister, I haven't heard reference to education and the important role that that plays. You may well be coming on to it, but when you say it's almost exclusively enforcement I'm hearing from you, education has a key role to play, I'm sure you'll agree.
Minister?
I hear the member's point, but dealing with each of the recommendations in turn, I commit to Mr Finney, I will be getting on to education shortly. Another of the expert review group's recommendations related to licensing authorities and the attachment of restrictions and conditions to the sale of NPS when issuing public entertainment and similar licences. To progress this, both myself and Minister for Local Government and Community Empowerment, Mr Biaggi, wrote to all the Scottish licensing boards in June of this year, and in our letter we requested that local authorities amend public entertainment licences issued in order to ban NPS at forthcoming festivals and to include these conditions for licences that were not yet issued. This is thought to be beneficial as it not only assists in addressing the issue of availability at such events this year, but will also help prepare local authorities ahead of the new legislation. And I've asked officials to examine the extent to which local authorities are making use of these opportunities. Turning to education, to address the point Mr Finney raised, however, even in if displacement to other channels is not observed, legislation alone, we concede, will not solve the problem of NPS. Education is crucial, and that will continue to be a high priority for the Scottish Government. The well-established Know the Score information service and Choices for Life, delivered in partnership with Police Scotland, Education Scotland and Young Scot, have been supported by the Scottish Government to develop and deliver specific NPS material. The Scottish Government continues to fund CREW, a third sector drug service, to provide a training package and information resources on NPS and emerging trends to drug and youth services across Scotland. I am very grateful to CREW for their engagement and support to me as I attempt to grapple with this very important issue. And we have also funded the Scottish Drugs Forum. We have also been funded to improve the capacity and quality of interventions around the NPS and stimulant use in employment and housing services for young people. And I was very pleased on Saturday to build on that engagement with young people when I attended an event we sponsored with the Scottish Youth Parliament to raise the profile of NPS. At the event, young people from across Scotland discussed the best approaches to raising awareness of the dangers of NPS among young people, and I think it was important to get their perspective in this issue. Some initial findings suggested they felt the widespread accessibility of NPS was, and I quote, a scary thing, especially when combined with an equally widespread lack of awareness of the risks among their peer group. They also felt the provision of high-quality information was an essential part of any approach to tackling the use of NPS. Discussions also focused on how a peer-led approach to the issue of NPS was an important factor in tackling this issue. With respect to politicians in this chamber, messages from us probably don't carry as much weight as individuals who are seen to be identified as peers of young people. So that is an important factor, and very much took that on board. The Scottish Youth Parliament will develop and submit a comprehensive findings and recommendations report to the Scottish Government, and will also present their findings to the NPS Ministerial Cross-Party Working Group to inform members of that. I would like to thank the Scottish Youth Parliament members not only for organising the event, but for their contribution, and we will take these findings forward into our education and preventative messaging. The subject of NPS is an issue where there is a significant degree of consensus across the political spectrum. That's something I mentioned to the members of the Scottish Youth Parliament at the weekend. And to address these challenges, we do have to work together to tackle those substances that present risks to our communities and recognise that there are no easy answers. On the same day that the expert review group published its report in February, I made a statement in this Parliament where I invited my colleagues from across the parties to join me in a ministerial cross-party working group. I'm very pleased to say colleagues from other parties did accept the offer, and a group is now up and running, and I hope members agree it is providing a good source of information to members across the chamber to bring us all up to date to the latest trends. This group has met twice and continues to examine the work that is underway to build a shared understanding of the problem, hear from the experts in the field and oversee the work as it unfolds. Most recently, we heard from A&E practitioners on the harms they are seeing on sometimes a daily basis. And I think I can speak for a number of my colleagues in the group in saying I was genuinely taken aback at the extent to which individuals are presenting at A&E with what would appear to be psychotic conditions, which are actually a result of a medical reaction to the effects of NPS, such as overheating, falling use of stimulants. and I've been invited to spend an evening shift in an A&E department to see firsthand some of the challenges that professionals face with regards to NPS. I notice you're happy to volunteer, you're willing to come along in regard to NPS and other matters, and I'd be delighted to take up this offer. The group has a programme of work agreed and will meet into 2016, and it's intended a report of their main considerations will be produced, and I will bring this to the wider attention of the Chamber in due course. Whilst the group is not focused on making specific recommendations, I have been delighted with the ideas and insights being generated by members across this chamber, and these are being reflected in the work going forward. I am very grateful to members of the group for their interest and the consensual nature in which we've been able to conduct our business and the openness with which those have contributed have engaged with us. In closing, Presiding Officer, I would commend the work that the Scottish Government is doing with others to respond to the recommendations made in February by the Expert Review Group. I am sure members will acknowledge all that is being done, and I very much welcome the collaboration and support from members across the Chamber. This is a hugely significant challenge to the health and well-being of the people of Scotland, and we must focus our minds on how best we can deliver a Team Scotland approach to contain and then hopefully eliminate the harms caused by new psychoactive substances. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. And I now call on Graeme Pearson. 9 minutes or so, Mr Pearson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government motion welcomes the Expert Review Group report recommendations, and on behalf of the Labour Party, I would contribute to that note of welcome and also thank the group for the hard work that they've done on behalf of the Parliament. Scottish Labour supports the Government motion, and we will be voting accordingly at the end of this brief, though important, debate on the issue. New psychoactive substances, NPS, known in some communities as legal highs, but perhaps better described as lethal highs in some families, are a scourge and a growing menace affecting our society. New psychoactive substances can be legal, some illegal, and sometimes both together in a cocktail. Across the European community, and Scotland is little different in this respect, the usage of NPS features largely younger age groups, and particularly those who attend as clubbers in our towns and cities at night. Methadone and synthetic cannabinoids have been the most common NPS available, though with a cornucopia of chemicals now entering the market each month to add to the challenges we face as a society, there is a changing fashion in the types of substances that are being consumed. Even so, only 1% of drug seizures in Scotland are identified as NPS. That level of recovery does not reflect the numbers of so-called head shops, more than 650 across Europe, with more than their fair share across Scotland, and the numbers of internet outlets retailing legal highs to customers of any age and with any pre-existing medical conditions would suggest that 1% seizure merely touches the tip of the iceberg. We know the main markets of supply emanate from China and India, but growing profits see laboratories across the globe entering with their enhancements of supplies to the market. Compounds are constantly changing as the illicit chemists try to keep ahead of the law, and there are 541 chemical potions, NPS, identified by December 2014 in the marketplace, according to the UNODC. The growing involvement of injecting NPS is a trend which is already showing itself, and it is a disturbing trend given the dangers already identified in connection with alternative means of ingestion. Kidney failures are known, and psychosis, all weighed at the feet of NPS in terms of identified outcomes for some patients. And NPS, as the Minister has acknowledged, has been implicated in up to 132 deaths since 2009, though 18 were identified as NPS being the sole drug identified. In these circumstances, the Government's actions at Scottish and UK levels in seeking to stem the growing tide of misuse and abuse is necessary and must be seen to work if we are to protect our citizens, particularly our young people. In terms of the motion, I too welcome the UK Government's stated commitment in May this year to introduce legislation banning new psychoactive substances. The provision of up to 7 years imprisonment for those who would produce and deal in MPS is, in my view, an effective deterrent, and I acknowledge the intentions within the legislation to avoid criminalising those who would be caught in possession of MPS. At the Scottish level, the intentions to create a centre of excellence in terms of forensic analysis and creating a database of information and intelligence will fill the knowledge gap that currently exists. It would be useful if greater detail regarding the who, the where, how much it will cost, and what success would look like once such a centre of excellence is created would be helpful in order that we could share that knowledge externally and create a confidence that the government has this matter in hand. I do have concerns regarding the abilities of local authorities across Scotland whose trading standards departments are reported to be already struggling to cope with smaller departments but greater demands. My colleague Elaine Murray raised the issue at topical questions coincidentally, but it does have implications given the guidance that the government intends to issue to assist staff in dealing with the challenge. The remaining staff within these departments on the front line will have difficulty in coping with additional guidance, and I'm sure that if some explanation can be offered in terms of the impact and additional resources that may be required in this regard would remove doubts in their mind about coping. Though information sharing and common definitions are always crucial in developing a successful plan, I do hope that both Scottish and UK governments will act together to ensure that UNODC and the United Nations Council will take all steps to encourage member states to eradicate those laboratories responsible for the supply of new psychoactive substances across the globe. It is in the interest of world health, and it will also help deal with international crime groups who profit greatly from this trade. The commitment to obtain an accurate picture in regard to MPS is to be welcome. The identification of the need to prepare new packs for education and public service frontline is also necessary. New treatment protocols need to be created, as do the pathways to divert young people away from substance abuse generally and MPS, particularly in the context of this debate. And a commitment to use licensing regulations to prevent head shops at festivals and concerts, and planning regulations where possible to manage town centre estates, together with their usage and HMRC to ensure that profits from such enterprises are identified, and if not subject to the proceeds of crime legislation, then levels of taxation are applied and collected. Such action would be highly desirable in persuading those who would take advantage of young people in this environment to adopt other business practices. In the end, the use of MPS, particularly in the context of polypharmacy, that is, the cocktail of substances such as cocaine, heroin, prescription drugs, alcohol and tobacco, present a really troubling challenge in maintaining healthy communities capable of sustaining a productive lifestyle for the future. One can hope the steps outlined in the government's motion represents a successful first step in our efforts to provide for the future a safe and a healthy environment for all. As was stated by my colleague, Mr. Finney, the concentration on education, clear education of the full knowledge of the damage that's done by these substances, is crucial to any successful outcome in this matter. And I hope that the government and the wider drug strategy will apply themselves with vigour to ensure that our drugs deaths fall and those who create a problematic drug abuse are reduced as soon as is possible. Thanks very much.
Many thanks. And I now call on Margaret Mitchell. 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I hope today's debate will serve to increase awareness and help educate the public at large about the horrors associated with taking new psychoactive substances, NPS for short. The fact that NPSs are more frequently termed legal highs and openly on sale online and in head shops throughout Scotland serves only to confuse the issue. For there's absolutely no doubt, without exception, there are huge risks in the consumption of these so-called legal highs, whether taken in capsule form, snorted, smoked, or injected for a faster hit, and also potentially horrendous consequences. These include incidents of confirmed deaths, multiple amputations, paranoid delusions, attempted murders, suicidal tendencies, and violent and sexual crimes. Whilst labelled not for consumption, they serve no other practical purpose. There is no information on dosage as a result of their accessibility, affordability, and the anonymity of their purchase. They are readily available to young people well under the age of 18. In East Kilbride, the Chief Inspector warned of a frightening increase in the number of young people in the area admitted to A&E departments after taking potentially fatal legal highs. This followed on from an incident last year when a 13-year-old pupil from the town was rushed to hospital during a school break after taking a suspected legal high. Just this month, the Falkirk Herald reported that two children, a 12-year-old boy and a 14-year-old girl, were rushed to the emergency department at Forth Valley Royal Hospital after ingesting new psychoactive substances from blotter paper. And Louise Grant. Yes, certainly.
John Finney.
Thank you, President Officer. I'm grateful for the member taking intervention at that point. Is the member able to give comparable statistics for alcohol abuse with juveniles?
Margaret, I can't do it at this point, but I'm sure they could be found somewhere and the comparison made. And Louise Grant, a harm reduction worker, confirmed we are finding more and more people coming through the door who are taking legal highs. People come to us and they're not engaging with addiction services because they think the drugs they are taking are legal. In May, 25-year-old Jamie Donnelly died at Forth Valley Hospital after taking legal highs. And at the same time, a 16-year-old girl was found having a fit in the street after allegedly buying one of the substances. But despite locals in Falkirk launching an angry campaign against a local shop which they blame for peddling legal highs and a special event at Denny High School just before the summer holidays where local police gave an anti-NPS presentation to pupils, it is evident that the risks are not being hammered home. The stark fact remains, these legal highs are still out there, still for sale, and people are still taking them in Lanarkshire, Forth Valley and throughout Scotland. And in Edinburgh, with as many as 15 head shops, it's fast becoming the legal high capital of the UK. So I warmly welcome the developments the Minister outlined in his opening speech. For according to the most recent figures for drug-related deaths in Scotland, NPSs were a factor in the person's death in 60 cases in 2013, compared with 32 in 2012. With the speed and scale of the emergence of new substances showing little sign of abating, this multifaceted and escalating problem must and can only be eliminated by adopting a coordinated approach. It's encouraging, therefore, that there has been some substantial progress in tackling NPSs over the past year, including the introduction of the new Psychoactive Substances Bill in the UK Parliament. This draft legislation makes it an offence to produce or supply so-called legal highs and introduces a maximum prison sentence of 7 years for these crimes. The recommendations of the expert review group reported earlier this year have now gone out to consultation. They include the need for a clear and practical definition of NPS, the creation of a forensic centre to lead on the detection and identification of these dangerous substances, and the need for improved data collection and information sharing among stakeholders. And it's the problems associated with data collection that I want to explore more fully. For example, whilst Police Scotland recognises the severity of the NPS problem, it was unable to provide a response to a straightforward request for the number since 2013 of new psychoactive substances seized from persons on their arrest. This information would have at least provided a valuable snapshot of what's happening on the ground. Furthermore, when asked about NPSs recovered during a consensual or statutory stop and search, Police Scotland again said that it was unable to provide this information because of problems with the stop and search data. Meanwhile, following a similar Scottish Prison Service information request, it replied that this information is not held by the SPS, as current SPS drug testing equipment is unable to identify new psychoactive substances. Yet in June, the National Offender Management Service in England and Wales highlighted that NPSs have resulted in serious assaults, disturbed and disruptive behaviour by prisoners, heightened levels of intimidation and increased levels of debt. Nor was the Solicitor General able to provide figures for the number of people supplying NPSs who have been convicted under the common law of reckless and culpable conduct when asked for this information in this chamber in February. For the reasons outlined above, I am therefore disappointed that the amendment in my name was not selected for debate, especially as this was intended to highlight the Scottish Government's inclusion of data collection in the consultation on the expert review group's recommendations, which have unequivocal cross-party support. However, I confirm that the Scottish Conservatives will support the Government's motion this evening, despite the fact it makes no mention to the crucially important issue of data collection.
Many thanks, and I now turn to the open debate. Speeches of a generous 6 minutes, and I call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Dr. Richard Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First of all, I think that it is absolutely incumbent on all of us to ensure that we never use the terminology legal highs to describe new psychoactive substances, as this often creates the impression among some folk that they are safe because they are technically legal. And I think that that couldn't be further from the truth. I'm pleased that the Scottish Government has agreed to implement all of the recommendations of the expert review group, and I hope that this will help tackle the availability and use of new psychoactive substances. Many of my constituents and I have been extremely concerned about the growth and availability of these substances, and it is disturbing that shops selling new psychoactive substances have sprung up in Aberdeen and other areas right across Scotland. We have already seen Aberdeen City Council secure a closure order at one shop because of, and I quote, antisocial behaviour arising from the sale of MPS on the premises. Unfortunately, the owners of this shop moved quickly to establish a new premises and are plying their dubious trade once again. In recent weeks, we've seen another shop open just yards away from Skene Square's primary school in Aberdeen. And it is galling that at present, nothing can be done to stop this operation. Parents are rightly concerned about having such a shop on the route to their children's school. And I share their concerns. And I do hope that folks will not have to put up with this kind of situation for much longer. Concerns have also been expressed to me by the Aberdeen Arts Centre and Theatre about the proximity of another shop to their facility. ACT have a lot of young members and volunteers, and they are rightly worried that these young folks are being exposed to MPS on a day and daily basis.
It's positive that the government have said that they will put conditions and restrictions regarding the sale and use of MPS on public entertainment and similar licences. But can the minister broaden the licensing regime so that any shop selling MPS or drug paraphernalia has to be licensed by a local authority? I believe if this were to happen, it would stem the flow of such shops, and that would be very, very welcome by my constituents in Aberdeen and by people right across the country. Education is absolutely vital. At the beginning of my speech, I appealed for us to change our language to ensure that folk recognise the dangers of new psychoactive substances. I pay tribute to the police in Aberdeen and Transition Extreme, who have held seminars warning of the dangers of MPS. But in my opinion, these educational opportunities must be expanded, and we must ensure that every young person knows of the dangers of taking new psychoactive substances. They are not safe. Can the minister, in his summing up, please give us an indication of whether guidance will be given to schools to teach kids about the dangers of MPS? And can he tell us if resources will be made available to organisations like Transition Extreme, who are already making efforts to educate young people about new psychoactive substances? And I think in organisations like Transition Extreme, they have various experiences which I think can be brought to bear and help in educating young folk. I recognise that the Scottish Government is working closely with the UK Government on this issue to ensure that the new Psychoactive Substances Bill works well for Scotland. I recognise that the new bill will create new criminal offences to produce, supply, offer to supply, possess with intent to supply, import and export psychoactive substances. But that is unlikely to be implemented before April 2016, which is still a fair way off. I realise that this is a complex piece of legislation, but I hope that it will be in place sooner rather than later. In my opinion, uncontrolled new psychoactive substances may actually pose a greater threat than some controlled drugs, and we must do all that we can to protect our young folk from these dangerous substances. And I hope that today, Presiding Officer, the Parliament will unite and back this motion. I hope that today we will all say to the UK Government that we would like to see the new legislation implemented as soon as possible. And that today we will commit to ensure that the language that we use to describe new psychoactive substances is the right languages, so as folk recognise and realise that these substances are extremely dangerous and that they should not buy or take them. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I perhaps should have been slightly clearer with my generous 6 minutes. I can actually give members up to 7 minutes. Dr. Richard Simpson, to be followed by Graham Day.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The history of new psychoactive substances really began with MDMA and LSD in the 60s, and by the 80s and 90s, MDMA, which is an amphetamine-like substance, became such a problem that it was banned. But of course, criminals then began changing the molecule to get round the ban, and new synthetic semi-industrial chemicals began to appear. GHB, gamma hydroxybutyrate, was found in a cleaning fluid for alloy wheels and got people high. Mephedrone, or meow meow, is a fertiliser. So you can buy and sell things legally that have a legal purpose, but of course when they're subverted into human use and sold in different packaging, which is highly displaying, even if it says not for human consumption, it's going to be consumed. In terms of the sales are through ClearNet websites, but also dark side websites, but also, of course, the estimated 250 head shops in the UK selling these products. But the search by the chemists is constant for legal substances which can be subverted. And the problem with these legal highs is not that they exist, because they've always existed since time immemorial, and human beings, being what they are, will continue to seek legal highs, or they will continue to seek highs, whether we call them legal or not. So that's a real problem that we have to face. The problems are with quality assurance, which is non-existent, and the fact that we've no real idea about dosage. Now, a legal drug requires extensive testing on cells in vitro, then animal studies in phase one, then novel use in humans in phase two, and condition testing for dosage and side effects in phase three, large trials costing perhaps around $1 billion to bring a drug to the market. And even then, they're not totally guaranteed to be safe. And colleagues, if we think that actually everything that is out there, is we can make this safe in some way, protect people, we're living in a fool's paradise. So we have to try hard, but we also have to be very cautious. Every weekend in pubs, clubs and bedrooms, people are engaging in what is in effect phase one trials of new psychoactive substances. No idea of what they're taking, no real idea of what the dosage is. And not, frankly, a situation that's going to be improved by a rolling prohibition making this a criminal offence. And so I welcome the fact that the bill is not going to do this for personal possession. But the chemists will simply move on to the next product. So we're engaged in whack-a-mole and firefighting. Moreover, alteration to chemical formulae are not that difficult to make. So we've tried to say, unless it's the core chemical, the core molecule that's being altered, it would continue to be illegal. And that was one of the approaches that we took. But the temporary class drug orders have been successful and useful, and extending them is happening under the Act, I think, is valuable. But if any of us as politicians think we can get ahead of the game simply by speeding up the categorisation of new psychoactive substances under the Misuse of Drug Acts, or indeed under new legislation, we are deluding ourselves. We do need new approaches, but it is going to be difficult. So one strategy is to control the head shops. Ireland, hugely successful. Introduced the ban in 2010, no evaluation of their act, zero arrestable offences, the head shops have disappeared, but NPS use continues to abound in Ireland, and it abounds now entirely in the criminal area. No licensing, but the activity continues. So I caution that these bans that are being proposed are going to work and be sufficient, much as we would desire them to be. Now, surveillance and information is good, but of course that's retrospective. The wedinos.org site in Wales, you can send your sample of your NPS to them. It can be sent to their lab anonymously, and 3 days later you'll have an analysis, and that can tell people what's actually happening. So, for example, the drug Sparkle in Wales is entirely mephedrone, but in Edinburgh it's a combination of mephedrone and ethylphenidate, which is a Ritalin derivative. So the same drug under the same name is different in different places. And on one occasion, Sparkle produced such an effect, the person was rendered unconscious for about 3 days, and they discovered that it was nothing to do with these products, mephedrone. It was a combination of heroin and methamphetamine. In Holland, they test in clubs, and that's something I would like to see. Because people will continue to use, however much we want to stop them, they will continue to use in clubs, they will continue to use at outdoor events, big events, they will continue to use it. So people being able to bring their product and see if, in fact, it is what it says on the tin, is useful. And colleagues, LSD, having been very small, continues to be very small. But the use of ecstasy, having reduced, has increased again very substantially in the last couple of years. Thousands upon thousands of youngsters are using ecstasy every weekend, and we would want them to be safe. However, I doubt if we're going to. The government has their website, which is also helpful, but information for these young people is mainly gained through the internet and increasingly through social media, that they communicate with each other as to what these particular brand products, and they are brand products, are there, coming from mainly from China and the Far East. There's been an early warning system in place since 2011 in the UK, in the EU. There was a G8 agreement on where we should go forward and a proposed set of EU regulation, which the UK coalition has opted out of, believing the controls were inadequate. But the new blanket ban is described by Professor Nutt as being based, a policy based on second-hand reporting of flawed data, and is extremely worrying. He believes that the deaths from NPS in 2012, claimed to be 97, was actually less than 10 and probably none. And many are critical of the blanket ban on NPS in Ireland. There's, as I said, there's been no formal evaluation. A surprising number of young people do use these substances. 8% in the last survey conducted in Europe, 8% of young people using these substances. And people will continue to experiment when we try to prevent, whether we try to prevent them or not. I suggest, colleagues, we look very closely at what's happening in New Zealand. I think that's a very interesting approach. We will see. They are actually proposing to license what could, will be, indeed, legal highs. The producers will have to determine that it's safe. I will finish on this note, Deputy Presiding Officer, even with the extended time which your predecessor allowed me. And that is to say that I think that the current bill has merit, but it will need to be evaluated and the data will need to be, have to be collected very carefully. And frankly, criminalising even the things that we are trying to criminalise has tended to drive this into the hands of the clinical fraternity. Now, in America, there are more states now who are removing the ban on cannabis, and that's an experiment we should watch with great interest. A taxable, quality-assured market is not harm-free, but it's likely to be a lot less harmful.
Thank you. I now call on Graham Day to be followed by Alison McInnes. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll be pleasantly surprised if this debate commands very much in the way of column inches in our newspapers tomorrow. The consensual nature of the afternoon, both in terms of members' contributions and the highlighting of interagency and indeed intergovernmental cooperation, is not the stuff to stir the interest of papers. And yet the subject matter, as I think the cross-party commitment to working together to respond to the challenges posed by NPS indicates, is hugely important. The briefing that members of the Ministerial Cross-Party Group on NPS received a few weeks ago from an A&E consultant laid bare for all of us, I think, the nature of NPS's impact on users and the health service, both in the immediate and as regards mental health longer term. I don't mind admitting, I think like the Minister did, I was stunned by some of what we heard. The physical challenges being faced by A&E staff as they attempt to restrain patients in a state of excited delirium in order to administer treatment. The fact that traditional drug testing methods very often produce negative results, leaving staff guessing what patients may actually have consumed. That a sixth of a teaspoon of synthetic cannabinoid can put an adult in a coma for 23 hours. 2 micrograms of a particular NPS would put you over the drink drive limit, and the toxicity of another is such it dissolves skin tissue. And of course, the emerging evidence of profound effects on mental health. Now, it's important that we get all of this in context. In percentage terms, alcohol and illegal drug misuse continues to impose a greater burden on our NHS and exact a far greater toll on the population. Nevertheless, NPS is a growing problem, as evidenced by the fact that from 2012 to 2013, the number of drug-related deaths in which NPS was present rose by 150%, and in which NPS was implicated doubled. And it demands a wide-ranging, considered and appropriate response, which I believe we are seeing. The UK Government's Psychoactive Substances Bill is a welcome contribution to tackling NPS. There are issues to be explored around it. I think the joint response to the Home Affairs Committee's inquiry on the bill from Police Scotland, Trading Standards Scotland, the Scottish Police Authority and the Crown Office and Fiscal Service does highlight this, but it has the potential to represent a significant step forward and we should acknowledge it as such. The Scottish Government's investment in developing an appropriate forensics response to the spread of NPS is a similarly positive development. The purchase of a nuclear magnetic resonance scanner to fill the scientific void that not even mass spectrometers can fill, and the recruitment of specialist staff to deliver the comparator evidence that is presently lacking is important. And the Government's recently issued trading standards guidance, based upon best practice examples, some of which are drawn, as the Minister noted, from the area of the country that I represent, will help direct enforcement, particularly as regards so-called headshots, until the new bill is enacted. Education is going to be critical. We're told that 4% of 15-year-olds admitted in a 2012-13 survey to using NPS at least once. The actual figure, I suspect, is almost certainly higher. Know the Score and Choices for Life are useful vehicles for reaching out to young people, but we need to be sure that we're reaching every group within that age range, including young carers who can find themselves under enormous pressures. So I welcome the Minister's dialogue with the Scottish Youth Parliament on this issue, and I look forward to hearing the outcome of the work that they will take forward. But of course, we've got evidence emerging of increased usage amongst older age groups, including, amazingly, the 65s plus, and not just within the most vulnerable sectors of society. So then tailored messaging on the harms of NPS is going to have to be shaped for everyone. There remains gaps in our knowledge around the NPS. The full extent of online purchasing is one. What's motivating the spread of usage? The scale and nature of acute and long-term health harms, for example. We need to anticipate potential unwelcome consequences of actions already taken or going to be taken. I voiced concern in the Chamber before about whether bans simply drive supply underground or, more accurately, onto the internet. It's a concern the Minister echoed in opening and which was noted in the response to the Home Affairs Committee that I noted earlier. In Ireland, as we've heard, they banned head shops and supply through Irish domain names, but they could not control internet activity from elsewhere. While adopting the same approach in the UK main, we too potentially still face the same difficulty. That's not to say we shouldn't do it, far from it. I just note that concern. And another area I would seek reassurance of concerns rapid information sharing across the NHS. It's not just routine data which needs to be accessible, but early access to information and new and emerging trends, best practice in responding to some fairly testing scenarios that our A&Es are being confronted with on a weekly basis. Collaboration will be everything as we seek to respond to NPS. I therefore very much welcome the tone and the content of the consultation document launched earlier this month, particularly in Section 4, referring to the functions of the Planned Forensic Centre for Excellence. Given the scale and the nature of the challenge that NPS presents, we must avoid reinventing the wheel. NPS does not recognise national or indeed international boundaries, nor must the response to it. So I was pleased to see the proposal to link in with other data sharing services, such as the UK Forensics Early Warning System and the Welsh Emerging Drugs and Identification of Novel Substances project. Presiding Officer, there is no room for complacency on this issue, but like others, I would commend the work supported across this chamber that's being done to counter the menace of NPS, both here in Scotland and at Westminster. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now call on Alison McInnes to be followed by Christian Graham. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Convener, Presiding Officer. The burgeoning use of NPS, coupled with a growing understanding of the dangers, has led to a greater focus on how to control these substances. The UK Government's expert panel review, set in train by the previous Minister for Crime Prevention, a fellow Liberal Democrat, Norman Baker, highlighted that, and I quote, after years of stable and declining drug use, the emergence of NPS has been a game changer. That review gave us a wealth of information which has since been augmented by the Scottish Government's later and more focused expert review into the current legal framework available to Scottish public authorities to govern the sale and supply of NPS in Scotland. That group had quite a deliberate and specific legal focus, but it also considered operational and practical aspects in the context of the existing legal framework. Following these two reports, we've seen a lot of useful activity. The UK government has introduced a bill that will apply across all the jurisdictions of the UK. Local authorities and trading standards have worked with police to tackle so-called head shops, although it's worth remembering that it's not only head shops, but also in some cases, corner shops and ice cream vans that are dealing in this lucrative but damaging trade. The Minister for Community Safety has set up a ministerial cross-party group to ensure that we all understand the scale of the problem in Scotland. And can I take a moment to commend the Minister for this inclusive approach and agree that by sharing information and intelligence in this way, we should be better able to act collectively. And I have found attendance at that group hugely beneficial. I can assure the Minister of my support for that way of working. I want to raise some concerns that I have about the approach being taken in the Psychoactive Substances Bill, which proposes a blanket ban on all psychoactive substances, with the exception of exempted items such as caffeine and alcohol. In July, the Advisory Committee on the Misuse of Drugs raised a number of concerns about the bill as it's currently drafted. such as the omission of the word novel, which has widened the scope of the bill beyond that originally intended, that the psychoactivity of a substance cannot be unequivocally proven, that an impossible list of exemptions will be needed, and that the bill unhelpfully uncouples the concept of harm from control of supply, importation and production. And these shortcomings risk derailing or delegitimising the bill as it stands. But since then, the ACMD has reviewed the definition in the Psychoactive Substances Bill and proposed a revision to the Home Secretary. And that reads as follows. Psychoactive substances which are not prohibited by the UN Drug Convention of 1961 and 1971 or by the Misuse of Drugs Act 1971, but which may pose a public health threat comparable to that posed by substances listed in these conventions. And that seems to me a much more sensible and more measured approach that could attract support. No doubt, whatever shape the bill takes as it progresses, it will herald the end of head shops. But given the extent and reach of internet sales, that will not solve the problem. Indeed, research shows that disrupting a supply market often leads just to displacement of that market. And that's why education is as important as enforcement. NPS are game changers in many ways, and not least in the impact their use is having in the public health arena. Some of the key harms associated with NPS use are overdose and temporary psychotic states and unpredictable behaviours, attendance at A&E, sudden increase in body temperature, heart rate, coma, and risk to internal organs, sometimes with catastrophic or lethal results. Hallucination, confusion leading to aggression and violence, and many longer-term issues just beginning to become apparent relating to mental health issues, psychosis, paranoia, and anxiety. Education must target all users. There's often a focus, and we've heard it already this afternoon, on young people, but there are clearly, as Graham Day said, very many different user groups. I think it's also crucial that education on NPS and their effects is not just targeted at the potential users of these drug variants, but extends to health professionals and other public sector workers such as police, prison staff and teachers. Understanding better the manifestations of NPS poisoning could be a lifesaver. Understanding that acute behavioural disturbance could be the sign of a medical emergency rather than a mental health issue will mean more effective early intervention, perhaps preventing cardiac arrest or acute temperature spikes. Understanding that the aggression manifested when under the influence of some of these drugs is unlikely to respond to normal restraint methods is likely to save emergency workers from harm. And understanding the mental health impacts will have an effect on the shaping of psychiatric services and addiction services for the future. I support the motion today and trust the consensual nature of our debate this afternoon will mean we can continue to make progress in minimising the risks of NPS.
Many thanks. I now call on Christine Graham to be followed by Sarah Boyack, a generous 7 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In March this year, a young Gorebridge man, David Lewis, died after injecting a psychoactive substance that was called Burst. It took him 7 weeks to die, and after many operations, septicemia took his life. Following that, one of my local papers, the Midlothian Advertiser, launched a campaign to ban these substances. I joined that campaign, and in the same month, through a third party, purchased a so-called, in inverted commas, legal high from a shop selling e-cigarettes in Dalkeith. That third party was a reformed drug addict, and he agreed to masquerade as a purchaser, as he too was concerned at how easy such a purchase could be made. The shopkeeper produced a small packet containing a white sparkly powder from under the counter for, I think it was £10. The packet had printed on it, not for human consumption, and another somewhat glamorous name. Now, it seems to me that the very actions of that shopkeeper, the subterfuge, the whole method and conduct of the sale, and he would have recognised that third party and his addictive past, leads me to the conclusion, beyond reasonable doubt, that he knew, notwithstanding the printed warning on the packet, that purchase was for human consumption and was dangerous. So while I will support legislative moves here and indeed elsewhere across these aisles, I wonder why the police and Crown Office have not made use of common law. And Alison McInnes made reference to the difficulties of definition in the UK legislation, and I think these will persist. So I plead in my argument the precedent of prosecutions, and successful at that, of glue sniffing. And I quote the case of Calleek and Anor v. the Lord Advocate, High Court of Justiciary on Appeal in 1983. Two shopkeepers in Glasgow were arrested and charged inter alia with supplying to children glue sniffing kits consisting of a quantity of petroleum-based glue in a plastic bag. They gave notice of injection to the indictment when it was served on them, averring that on the charge of supplying, the facts as libel did not disclose a crime known to Scots law, because there was nothing illegal about the items they had supplied. Their plea was repelled at a preliminary diet and they appealed. On appeal, the High Court took the view that even though EvoStick glue in plastic bags might be perfectly legal, everyday items, the two shopkeepers knew perfectly well what the children were going to use the articles for, and the charge and the indictment should stand. The court refused to accept that there was any distinction between supply with knowledge of likely abuse and actual administration of a dangerous substance to a child. The Lord Justice General Emsley said, quotes, "There is ample authority for the view that the willful and reckless administration of a dangerous substance to another causing injury or death is a crime at common law in Scotland." Now, it seems to me the supply of materials for ingestion or injection for purposes of a, quotes, high, which are known or likely to cause injury or death, fits the same bill as the successful glue-sniffing prosecutions. And I don't understand why, to the best of my knowledge, there have not been any prosecutions. Annabel Goldie raised this in a question herself, S40/04048, and myself at S4W04048, which was answered on the 1st of April, and I quote, "COPFAS issued guidance to Police Scotland August 2014 prior to their National Day of Action on 22nd August under Operation Redwall. The guidance specifically covered the use of the offence of culpable and reckless conduct and the type of evidence that would be required." It goes on to say, "The group considered," this is the review group, "considered the use of the common law offence of culpable and reckless conduct and looked at the case of Calleek v HMA. They concluded that the offence of culpable and reckless conduct could be relevant to the sale and supply of NPS in certain circumstances." You see, for me, I don't understand why common law has not been tried and used. That renders redundant the need for a definition, which I think is always going to be tricky because there's all kinds of exemptions under the proposed bill at the House of Lords. It may be that blockage, and it's referred to in page 36 of the report of the review group, is the route that's been taken, which seems to me to be under unfair commercial practices, in particular consumer protection from unfair trading regulations, where the seller has to be doing misleading actions and or misleading omissions. But of course the purchasers know what they're doing. They know that what they're buying in many circumstances is dangerous, so that doesn't fit the bill, but I don't see why that's the only route that is being considered for prosecutions. Because the great thing about Scots law, common law, is that it finds a way of filling gaps in the law, and it's often much more flexible and less heavy-handed than statutes, which can be terribly clumsy because it's so hard to define every circumstance in which it can be effective and which someone cannot rebut or defend at court. And I go back to David Lewis, the chap who regrettably and terribly died from injecting this, when his father said of the shopkeeper, "These people know what they are doing." Indeed they do. It is reckless and willful conduct. And to me, I'd like the minister to answer me, as nobody has so far, why on earth the Lord Advocate and the police have not taken this route and tried it out as they so successfully did with glue sniffing in the 1980s. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Now call on Sarah Byatt to be followed by Nigel Dawn. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I want to focus on local coordination and harm reduction. The challenges caused by NPSs in Edinburgh are particularly distinct, and at the heart of the action to reduce the strain and harm caused to individuals and the wider community has been coordination on a local basis. And if we want to tackle NPS use effectively and prevent harm, a one-size-fits-all approach won't work. To tackle the specific problems in each city and town, efforts must be local, supported by responsive national agencies and legislation. And as others have commented today, the intravenous use of one substance, ethylphenidate, has been the focus of difficulties in Edinburgh. Cheap, considered purer and of better quality than street drugs, harm reduction services report it is frequently used in combination with other street drugs. And because it has an intense, short-lived high, users re-inject frequently, and that has created a surge in problems for both users and local communities. The Edinburgh Alcohol and Drug Partnership recorded needle distribution growing virtually month on month in the period April 2014 to this March. And while NHS Lothian saw increases in infections caused by needle use, including streptococcus, communities, the police and our council saw a wider impact. Frequent use resulted in users experiencing erratic and sometimes exhibiting antisocial behaviour. And residents in the Southside, Tollcross and City Centre were distressed to come across people with a frequent need to re-inject, using their stairs and leaving behind drug-related items. We've also had queues outside head shops early in the morning. Since the temporary class of drug order banned ethylphenidate, giving police the power to control and patrol high street head shops and to seize and destroy any substance, there has been a marked change in Edinburgh. Infections and injecting are down, and support services have been able to make progress in the way in which they respond and reduce harm. At the heart of dealing with localised NPS use is ensuring that the council, the police, the NHS and charities such as Comas are enabled to work together. Support services in Edinburgh are pioneering ways to reduce usage, manage cravings and prevent relapse, responding to this emerged problem. Mental health and emotional support services are particularly crucial to complement this to support people going forward. But we still need more capacity building and training among staff to ensure that services are coordinated within the NHS, the police and the council. We need a clear picture about local trends, and it's crucial for A&E departments to treat admissions, building into a bigger picture. Much needed data gathering initiatives are underway in Edinburgh. NHS Lothian has conducted focus groups, and the Needle Exchange Survey Initiative will gather information on the habits of users next month. And in tackling the local supply, trading standards have been able to work constructively with the police and those retailers where NPS is not the traditional or mainline business. Those efforts need to be resourced. So I would say that in Edinburgh, efforts to rely on existing regulations legislation is being investigated, and I call on the Minister to commit resourcing to ensure that those options can be fully explored and acted upon. For example, landlords, including the council as a landlord, have a responsibility to ensure that commercial tenants are compliant with the temporary legislation and operate in an ethical manner. Again, support for the Minister could help to reinforce this. Recommendations to provide a new definition of NPSs and a framework for testing will further support detection and identification and are welcome. But the national framework must not downplay or deprioritise the importance of local progress and work done by local agencies. Caledonian Youth and Crew 2000 had a good track record of passing on samples of legal highs to the police forensic services. But with forensic services centralising under Police Scotland, that relationship and local integration has now been lost. Edinburgh's experience with intravenous drug use in the 1980s was absolutely harrowing and affected a generation. We then had the AIDS Control Act, pioneered by Gavin Strang MP, which enabled local authorities to track and detail infection rates, provide information of the treatment provided, and that helped us to control the disease. Since those dark days in the 1980s, Edinburgh has worked hard supporting those who misuse substances and prevent harm to individuals and the wider community as well. Local coordination of treatment, rehabilitation and public education have been absolutely key to minimise harm reduction. If we look to Wales, The Wedendoss system shows how the NHS and justice systems can integrate well and cascade harm reduction guidance to local support services. Originally an informal mechanism to profile and map harm of samples of unknown and identified drugs by the Cardiff Toxicology Laboratories, it pioneered a focused forensic operation to prevent harm. So we need to make sure that national action must ensure that resource and discretion is responsive to local demands and to foster coordination in communities across Scotland. Local knowledge and coordination with our city has been crucial to achieve effective harm reduction. Scottish Labour's amendment rightly calls for a coordinated plan of action to reduce the damage caused by NPSs. Graeme Pearson's references to more effective licensing and education, I think, lie at the heart of the way forward. Richard Simpson spoke eloquently of the need to ensure that people of all ages, but particularly young people, are given the information about the real damage that NPSs can pose. And whether that's in our schools, our colleges, our universities, or through social media, we need to make sure that there's accurate and thought-provoking information that young people can relate to and crucially can trust. It is a huge challenge and we need a coordinated response, and that response, Presiding Officer, needs to be delivered both nationally, but it needs to be delivered locally too, and the agencies need to be capable of delivering that resource. Thank you.
Much. Now call on Nigel Dawn to be followed by John Finney. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This is an interesting debate, not, of course, the first one on the subject. And as I think we all agreed last time around, this simply isn't easy. If there were a simple answer, we would have come up with it by now, and we know that there isn't one. And before I look at what we do know, Presiding Officer, I think we might just reflect, as has just been suggested, we might reflect on previous public health issues. AIDS was one. We've been dealing with drugs for generations now. And I think we need to recognise that we can do something to help if we get organised and coordinated, but the problem doesn't go away. And so we have to recognise where we're going to finish, which is never going to be where we really want to be, but hopefully we'll be in a better situation than we are currently identifying. Now, I'd like to start very locally to my communities by reflecting on what has worked, and the fact that a petition was put together very quickly earlier in the year by folk in Forfar who got the idea that there was going to be a head shop, realised that they really didn't want it, got more than 3,000 signatures, which in Forfar must be 40% of the adult population, within weeks, and effectively, with help from the council and the police and even some politicians, dare I say it, managed to persuade those who were thinking of actually opening this head shop that it really wouldn't be welcome and they shouldn't do so, and they didn't. And I want to pay tribute to Adele Douglas-Spears, Bobby Murray and Nikki Leithley in particular for bringing that petition, which I brought to the minister, and for having that enormously valuable effect on their community. So I think I can say simply from that one experience that where communities get organised, they can make that point to those who might be going to bring these substances onto the streets. But I have to reflect that it's less than 20 miles away in Montrose where we still have a head shop and it is still plying its trade. It is no more welcome, but it is established and it hasn't gone away. I want to pay tribute to the police and other local authorities who have done their best to make life difficult for that shop, but it is still there. I was speaking only yesterday to a headteacher from one of my local high schools, and he was able to reflect on his experience in two schools, one of which was a place where there was a head shop and another where there wasn't. And he was absolutely clear that the situation, as far as his school children was concerned, was chalk and cheese, precisely because of local accessibility through a shop. And I think that is entirely consistent with what we've seen in reports, which is that folk tend to get started when they can physically get their hands on their first sample from somebody or some place local to them. What comes from the internet might be the second, third, and fourth use. I think there is some evidence that people start with something they can get locally. Plainly, if they can't get it locally, that makes it far less likely they will ever start. The UK statute, which of course we've referred to, is not going to be a panacea, and I'm very grateful to Richard Simpson for his comments. I thought that was an extraordinarily useful input. Thank you, Dr. Simpson. And clearly what's going to happen is that this statute will have precisely the same effect as in Ireland, that open sales on the high streets will disappear, but the internet activity won't. And presumably that which gets sold from the boot of cars down the appropriate lane in the appropriate place at the dead of night won't stop either. The criminal world will always find a way of doing what it wants to do. The sad problem, of course, is that it will be fueled by the money that it can make doing it. And this brings us back to the old issue that if something's illegal, then there's money in it, and therefore the criminals will actually do it. If it wasn't illegal, then there wouldn't be money in it, and therefore it would be easier to control, is a general trend in all these discussions. I'd like to just make briefly the point, Presiding Officer, that if this statute is going to come in April, that may be some distance away, but it's actually a relatively short period. It does seem to me that all those who have got stock are going to want to get rid of that stock, and therefore we may see some marketing activity which will be extremely unwelcome over the next 6 months, and we might want to find a way of being prepared for that, because I think we can see it coming. If I can pick up on the issue of information, again, the point has properly been made that people will now get information about these very new materials online or through the social media. It may or may not be good information. There are sites which will tell you something which would appear to be fairly reasonable about some of the older established drugs. I'm just a bit concerned that it looks as though we have a position where people are going to get bad information, or they're going to attribute a degree of accuracy to the information they can find that's unreasonable. I have no idea how we get that information across, but education is, I think, the thing that everybody has spoken about. Somehow or other, we have to get people looking at MPS to realize that we don't know much about it. And any information which they think you're getting is probably guesswork. And that's one of the reasons why they're dangerous, because we really don't know very much about them. And if they do finish up in A&E, then it's very unlikely that anybody in A&E will know what's there, even if, and much about it, even if they could analyze which drug it was, which they may not be able to do. Which brings me, Presiding Officer, to another issue. I thought Kevin Stewart's comments about the words we use were entirely appropriate, and it came after a speech where one member had actually used the term legal high almost throughout. It is a fact that the implication of legal anything is that it's safe. Doesn't mean it to you and me, we know better. But to folk looking at something which is described as legal, it tends to suggest to them that it's okay. And therefore we really must stop using any term that implies these things might be okay, because frankly they are extraordinarily dangerous. And we do need, I think, if I can gently say it to the press, to actually understand that. It is irresponsible to suggest that something which is manifestly dangerous should be described as legal. It's just not the way to help our society. And would you please stop it? If we're going to a position where these materials, say in a year's time, are no longer visible on our high streets, then I return to where I started. What are we going to do next? Are we going to say that's okay then, they've gone away, because manifestly they haven't, we know they won't? I'm not sure that I have the answer here, but we're going to be in the same place as we are with controlled drugs. What's the strategy in the longer term? Is a question which I think we need to be asking very soon, because the longer term is not going to be very far away. So I commend everything that the government is doing. I actually do think the UK statute is a step in the right direction, because I think it will make a break point in current activity, which will be very welcome. But we do need to recognise that the future is not going to be sorted out by that kind of statute. It is only going to be sorted out by some serious education and some serious understanding as a result within our society that these things really shouldn't be meddled with, because you do so at your peril. And I therefore need to encourage the government to work with everybody who will get that message across. Thank you.
Many thanks. Many thanks. Now call on John Finney. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I very much enjoyed the debate, and I thank the Minister for bringing it here and for opening it. I wonder what the purpose of the debate is. Is it to highlight to the public a problem they're aware of? Is it to talk up a problem? Is it to address concerns that are widely held? Is it to reduce and inform harm? Is it to contribute to harm reduction? The motion talks about progress, and of course we will welcome progress. It's very important, and as a number of colleagues have said, I'm very pleased to be part of the ministerial group that's looking at this, and I think the no harm ever comes from discussing things, and I think we've had a lot of very informed discussion this far. The motion talks about engagement with the sector on information sharing, and I was led a while before I am grateful for the Minister for intervening about the issue of education. Education to me is key to this. It's absolutely key, and I wouldn't want to give the impression that my view that there's an overemphasis on enforcement is anything other than, if you like, my understanding of how we'll best get the message over that people need to make informed decisions. So, for instance, in the motion, it talks about the serious impact. Is it a serious impact? Serious compared to what? There are other comparators, and alcohol is the most obvious comparator. And we heard some very tragic events about how things turn out in accident and emergency. But these were relatively rare events, whereas we know that the incidence of alcohol and the mayhem that that creates, both in the streets, in our towns and villages, and dwelling houses, and in accident and emergency, has been an ongoing problem. Like others, I very much enjoyed Dr. Richard Simpson's contribution. I thought it was very informed. He talked about human nature and what human nature causes us to do. He talked about new approaches. He talked about the role of social media. And importantly, he said, they will continue to use. And I think that is the reality. I think, and at the risk of offending my former colleague in another sphere, Mr. Pearson, drugs enforcement, you could argue, has been not a positive outcome in terms of cost-benefits analysis. If the idea was of all this effort to reduce the availability of drugs, then that's not been the case. And, of course, this is out with the realm in some respects of the enforcement that has to.
Pearson?
Absolutely.
Thank you. I'm grateful to my colleague. I obviously can't let that remark go unchallenged. And I think that he should consider that over the years, in other realms of drug abuse, the so-called tenner bag that is recognised across Scotland at one time had a purity level of over 40% and now is lucky if it can achieve 10% in purity levels because the supply of drugs into the country has been choked. And what I would suggest is it's not simply a matter of enforcement, it's a proper use of all the tactics that's available to us that gives the opportunity for communities to respond better than otherwise might be the case. I'm grateful for allowing time to say that.
Thank you. John Finney?
Well, Mr. Pearson makes an important point, and that is enforcement has a role. It's a role as part of a whole. I would like the emphasis to be in education. The Scottish Drug Forum, they welcomed the Home Office review, and in welcoming, they said that one of the key issues limiting Scottish response to new psychiatric substance was the unknown prevalence, and that much of the data came from anecdotal information. And I think that largely remains the case, as we heard from the expert from Accident Emergency. There's a considerable amount of guesswork goes into it. But what I would also like to say from the document that was produced at that time by the Scottish Drug Forum, the director, David Little, said, and I quote, "It's crucial that the review does not solely focus on supply, but also looks at why people are using these substances and the impact that has on individuals." So I think it's very important that we do that. And we know that the review considered the internet, and of course the internet's there, and it's a very beneficial thing. Many people talk it down. It provides many of the challenges that we have. I think the Queen's speech talked about the new legislation and talking about it making it an offence that is about a substance for human consumption that is capable of producing psychoactive effect. And we've had a lot of discussion about that, because again, that may sound something very definitive. It's far from clear. Can I commend one of the aspects of the bill, and that is to include provisions for civil sanctions, so prohibition notices, premises notices, prohibition notices and premises notice, two breaches of which will be a criminal offence. And that was, quote, to enable the police and local authorities to adopt a graded response to the supply. And I think that is a proportionate response that's important that is taken. In the letter that the minister put out in June of this year, I highlighted in that he said, there are therefore potentially every bit as dangerous as illicit drugs, and no one would argue that, and have been implicated in a small but growing number of deaths. And we heard from Mr Pearson, indeed, in his contribution earlier about the polyuse of drugs. And if you look at the statistics, what I don't want is a situation where people are blowing something completely out of proportion. Alcohol is present in the vast majority of these drug-related deaths as well. Now, the minister also talked about Crew 2000, and Crew 2000 have been on the go since 1992 in response to the rapid expansion of recreational drug use. And Kevin Stewart talked about language, and language is very important, and I understand the frustration at the use of the term legal highs. But in another very sensitive matter, similar matter, in this chamber we've discussed the issue of female genital mutilation. Now, the connection there is, to a lot of people that meant nothing. The victims of that meant nothing. So yes, it's right that we don't infer that legal means safe. I don't take that anyway. It's legal to climb mountains. It's not always safe to climb mountains. But it's important that we communicate with people in the level that they will understand. So when the minister likewise talked about peers, with the greatest respect to my colleagues in here, it's not us in here people are going to listen to it. It is the Youth Parliament. It is the fine folk of the Drugs Forum. It is the fine folk of Crew 2000. And they say in relation to this legislation, first of all, they say what we've heard from Sarah Boyack and others about under-resourced and underfunded. They say better education is essential so as citizens are well informed and can assess risk. The information provided by government has been minimal, leaving those who take MPS to guess for themselves. Now, that's a phrase I've seen elsewhere. And, you know, if we are going to say don't do it, we maybe need to say why don't do it. They also talk about the least harmful substances, such as nitrous oxide, should be exempt. Now, I didn't know what that was. Apparently, it's laughing gas. But again, proportionality needs to come into this. We need to look at how we're going to deal, if this legislation goes through, what the after effects of that are. And again, Crew 2000 commends something that I haven't seen elsewhere, and that is a UK-wide NPS amnesty, which would reduce the possibility of redistribution. The consequences of a ban, of course, aren't just as straightforward as we would imagine. There are issues about people who may return to opiates from the non-opiate MPS, and they will have a reduced tolerance, and therefore there's the potential for increased overdose risk. Mental health problems may exacerbate people who choose to self-medicate. We are once again going to be driving people who may wish to continue using back into dealing with people who, after all, are criminals. The other comment that Sarah Boyack made that I would commend is the use of local initiatives. That's what's important. But we must deal with facts, we have to deal with the internet, and we have to work collaboratively to reduce harm and bring about informed decision making. Thank you.
Many thanks. Now Colin Roderick Campbell, up to 8 minutes, please, after which we'll move to closing speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate. As members will be aware, new psychoactive substances are harmful both psychologically and physically, presenting problems ranging from kidney failure to psychosis. NPS has been implicated in 132 deaths in Scotland from 2009 to 2013. And I heard what John Finney said on the use of the term legal high, but certainly with the minister, that's a term that's best avoided, because in my view, certainly implies that the associated substances are safe. However, we know that they're not safe. We also know that NPS are widely accessible. They can be purchased online or at head shops, 650 shops, as Graham Pearson referred to, in Europe alone. Head shops are institutions that show no sign of disappearing from our high streets. As we've heard, There is, of course, no law preventing the sale of goods which are often labelled and sold as plant food or bath salts or marked as not fit for human consumption. In addition, MPS are readily available in convenience stores and music festivals across Scotland and the UK. Nevertheless, we must avoid treating all head shops or music festivals as places that will necessarily harbour criminal activity. We need to approach matters on an evidence basis. But concern in our communities is real. The Courier today reports on concerns of a Perth pensioner about two local shops and what she perceives as a lack of interest in doing anything about it. As members will be aware, NPS are risky and have unpredictable side effects, with many people ending up in hospital. With so many of these drugs, it's impossible to tell what is contained within them before consumption. In 2013, NPS was stated to be the drug implicated in 5 deaths in Scotland, but mixed with other drugs and alcohol, NPS can be even more fatal, with 60 deaths in 2013, where NPS was implicated at least to some extent. There has, of course, been a growth in demand and supply of NPS, and countries have responded to that trend in 3 main ways. The first is enforcement. There are a variety of measures that can be used to place NPS under legal control. These include using the European Early Warning System to identify NPS and place them under control, or adding new substances to the 1961 or 1971 UN conventions. In the UK, as things stand, the British government can use the Misuse of Drugs Act 1971 to control substances by issuing a temporary class drugs order for up to 12 months. At that point, the UK government can investigate and recommend a classification if there is sufficient evidence to do so. However, a clear problem with this is that legal loopholes in control legislation have been exploited by drug manufacturers. Second approach, of course, is education, to which Mr. Finney has referred. Evidence shows that young people are the most likely to experiment with NPS. In Europe, an estimated 5% of people aged 15 to 25 had experimented with NPS. And in 2012-13, it was estimated that 2.1% of those in Scotland aged between 16 and 24 had used NPS. Therefore, it's crucial that we focus on educating our young people about the health risks associated with NPS. In Scotland, we must continue to support the Choices for Life initiative and websites such as Know the Score, as Graham Day has referred to earlier on. Education clearly must underpin any future legislation on NPS and indeed NPS policy. A third approach that's been taken by some countries is treatment. However, there's very limited information on what constitutes appropriate psychosocial treatment. Presiding officer, at a time when the number of new drugs available on the market is constantly changing and growing, with over 300 NPS identified in Europe in 2013, we really must seriously consider what we're dealing with and how to approach it, because there simply is no silver bullet solution. As members will be aware, the UK government introduced a psychoactive substances bill to the Westminster Parliament in May. As the Minister has already referred to, the maximum sentence under that bill will be 7 years imprisonment for those who produce, supply, offer to supply, possess with intent to supply, import or export psychoactive substances. According to the bill, psychoactive substances are any substance intended for human consumption that is capable of producing a psychoactive effect. However, there are some concerns about the bill, as Alison McInnes has already referred to. The Advisory Council on the Misuse of Drugs raised concerns about the use of the term psychoactive substances in the bill, believing that it would have a disproportionately broad scope. Furthermore, the bill's impact assessment was deemed to be inappropriate. The impact assessment was of the impact of new psychoactive substances rather than all psychoactive substances as laid out in the bill. Simply put, this made it problematic to list all possible desirable exemptions under the bill as drafted. And of course, psychoactivity cannot be defined through a biochemical test, so there are clear legal difficulties in proving it in a court of law. The only definitive way of determining psychoactivity is via human experience, which is usually not documented. Clearly, the UK government needs to continue to work with the ACMD and others to formulate advice on how to predict that a substance is likely to be psychoactive. Christine Graham referred to the use of the common law in Scotland, and obviously will commend that as a member of the Faculty of Advocates, and I should refer to my register of interest in that respect. But the Working Party report did make reference to the fact that that was something that could be used to control this. But they also referred to three main areas in which it poses problems, because to succeed in a prosecution for culpable and reckless conduct, suggested that evidence must be prevented to show that the seller knew or was reckless as to the fact that the product was being purchased for human consumption, And obviously we're well aware of attempts being made to label things as unfit for consumption. Another issue is that harm or potential harm to health is a factor which requires to be proved. So that not all will require analysis of the substance and expert evidence to establish its harmful effects. And can I just finish my point and then I'll take an intervention? And finally, the other matter referred to in this report was that it should be noted that the person prosecuted is more likely than not to be the shop assistant who carries out the sale rather than the person who's perhaps taking the key decisions further up the chain of supply. I'll take an intervention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Campbell. The fact is, in the circumstance I described, the shopkeeper was well aware. It was under the counter. It was in a small packet. It was handed over in a certain way. The whole process was one of subterfuge and a knowledge, of course, that this was a so-called reformed drug user who was buying it. So I think he was well aware of what was happening. And I wonder if the member would agree with me. Isn't it time that the Lord Advocate actually took a case and tried it?
1 minute or thereby, please.
I welcome that intervention. I think that there are circumstances in which the common law can be used, but all I was highlighting is there are circumstances in which its use would be more problematic. So it's a question of a kind of a bit of both, I would suggest to the member. Presiding officer, in conclusion, I welcome the recommendation by the expert review group that the definition of new psychoactive substances should be developed. It's clear that we do need consistency to be ensured across all areas, including research, academia, the NHS and government, etc. Common understanding is paramount. I also agree with the expert review group that consideration should be given as to whether the definition should be based on their chemical compound group or according to their effect, because we must be on the same page. And I also welcome the work of the Scottish Government engaging with the sector on information sharing and developing a common definition. The Scottish Government has been working hard on producing NPS guidance for trading standard staff, which we referred earlier on. Such guidance was published a couple of weeks ago. It's clearly crucial that people do work on the same page. And we've referred also to the instances of a lack of recording of NPS use by Police Scotland and the prison service. Again, I would like to get to the point where that information is recorded. Also, we need a joined-up national approach with local authorities. Entertainment licences are one obvious step. COSLA has a key role to play. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, can I congratulate the expert group on their work done to date?
Thanks very much. Now call on Alex Johnson. Up to 7 minutes, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I rise to support the motion in the name of the Minister, Paul Wheelhouse, and also to commend the way in which Paul Wheelhouse, in his ministerial responsibilities, has taken this matter forward. I think it's essential that we recognise that we are dealing with something new. It's there in the definition, and it's something we have much to learn about. As a father and a grandfather, it breaks my heart to watch each generation as it comes along find its particular mind-influencing substance of choice, and to see so many young people choose to infuse that substance into their body. We do so much in this Parliament and in other areas to reduce the effects of these substances, whether it's alcohol or tobacco or any of the other things that have come along over the years. We see success in some of these statistics as we begin to win the battle, and then something else appears. We've seen attempts over the years to bring forward new substances, and we've regulated them. But the onslaught of new and various substances that we face at the moment are raising us to a level of difficulty that I don't believe we've seen before. It has to be said that seeing the statistics, the number of people involved in taking these substances and having themselves damaged or on a few occasions killed by them is still small, and we still have a chance to work to sit towards success. But I believe the way that the government are tackling this and the way that they have taken the new Psychoactive Substances Expert Review Group report to heart and attempted to implement it is a good way forward. But yet, we have to work at this in every level. And it is the case that all over Scotland, People, even in their own communities, are doing what they can to highlight the problems that exist. In our Arbroath, just under 2 years ago, I was called to a meeting with people at the award-winning Arbroath Cafe project, which has done a great deal of good work with young people within that town. One of the so-called head shops had opened right across the road, and of course parents were outraged by that. I'd like to commend the action that was taken by parents, and particularly my good friend Derek Wan, who was instrumental in bringing that group together, for the work they did. But I also have to commend the action of local police officers who had the courage to do what few have done in other places, and that was raid the shop and effectively close it down. That kind of action will do a great deal of good where it can be taken, but as we've seen and heard during the course of the discussion today, it doesn't always happen. There's a lot of work being done within Scotland's local authorities, and problems that arose in Aberdeen were highlighted at Aberdeen City Council by my colleague, Councillor Ross Thompson, who has worked closely with me in my parliamentary role to try and highlight that problem as it exists in the North East. And without the work of local individuals and active councillors in individual council areas, we would not be at the point today where there is the level of understanding which we have, limited though it is. Among the things that have been highlighted in this debate, there are some that we've heard before. The use of the term legal highs is one that we should discourage, because simply because a substance is not illegal does not make it in any way harmless. We see exactly the opposite to be the case. We have to improve data sharing to ensure that everybody has the information they need, whether it's in terms of policing or whether it's in terms of dealing with the health implications of the drugs that are now on the market. At the last meeting of the Ministerial Cross-Party Working Group, it was a real eye-opener, if you excuse that expression, to hear A&E practitioners, actual clinicians who had experience of dealing with cases within accident emergency units, and explain how difficult it is to understand the problems that they are being faced with. They also were able to highlight the problems being experienced by police officers who are having to deal with people influenced by these substances, and yet finding that the traditional way of dealing with someone who has abused alcohol or a more traditional drug is simply not the way to treat people on some of these substances. And that inability to understand, to translate the needs of those who have used these substances and deal with them in a practical sense is one of the reasons why information and education is crucial throughout our process of dealing with this. Education for those who are likely to use the substances, education for those who will fall into their use not understanding the damage they can do, but also educating those who will be confronted in some professional capacity by someone who is influenced by a substance which we have little or no information about. There was one disagreement during the course of this debate, and that I think was highlighted by the positions taken by Richard Simpson and Christine Graham. These views are not wildly different, but they expose two alternative approaches. The regulation approach put forward by Richard Simpson, the light touch approach perhaps, if I can say that, contrasted with Christine Graham's view that we should take a more heavy-handed approach. I find it very hard to accept that we should not be prioritising the removal of these substances from our streets, but I also understand that if they're removed from our streets, we have not removed them from the hands of these young people who are using them. And that's why I think it's important that we also need to recognise, as has been said during the debate, that the countries where these substances are, or the raw materials are being manufactured, China and India, also need to be involved in at some level in what we're doing. I commend the work of the Minister, Paul Wheelhouse, and I commend the way he has dealt with this, both in Parliament and dealing with the passage of the legislation at Westminster. I think we are doing this the right way. Let's continue to work together towards our joint aims.
Many, many thanks. Now call on Dr. Elaine Murray. 7 minutes, please, Dr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And this has been an interesting debate, albeit scheduled at very short notice due to the withdrawal of the inquiry into death's bill. But it's been an opportunity to discuss the response to the expert review group and also the work so far of the cross-party working group on NPS and the development at UK level, developments at UK level since we last discussed this issue in February. Many members stressed the importance of not using the term legal high, because legal can be interpreted as meaning somehow okay and safe. But I think John Finney was right to stress that we need to use the language of the people involved, and there's no point in using terminology which we all understand if the people outside don't understand what we're talking about. The Minister quoted from the UK Government's Psychoactive Substances Bill, and the offence that it introduces. The bill also excludes legitimate substances such as food, alcohol, nicotine, caffeine, for example, and controlled drugs, which of course are already regulated, and also excludes certain persons such as healthcare professionals who may use NPS illegitimately during the course of their work. The definition of psychoactive substances is still up for discussion, and the Scottish Government is working with the UK Government, and I think we'll be keeping the working group informed of progress on that. However, it's generally considered that although the UK bill will help to stop supply from head shops, other things such as internet supply, although covered by the bill, will be much more difficult to control, as will indeed identification of the laboratories producing NPS, particularly when they're in China and the Far East. Nigel Don was said in his speech that he thought that might help to stop first use of NPS. However, if somebody has already tried it and they have friends who can get it on the internet, that will be more difficult to control. And I think Richard Simpson made an important comparison with Ireland, where legislation has been passed some years ago but not really has been assessed, but the use of NPS is still going on. Head shops aren't there, but the use is still going on. And Alison McInnes also highlighted reservations about the definitions in the bill. I found the one meeting of the working group which I attended, which was just a couple of weeks ago, extremely interesting. It concentrated on the medical and forensic implications of NPS. We heard from Dr. Richard Stevenson, emergency consultant of Glasgow Royal Infirmary, on the history of the discovery of various psychoactive substances and his very graphic accounts of the symptoms presented in his department, the sort of things his staff were seeing. And he dispelled any illusions that many of these substances are anything other than very dangerous, taken in the wrong sorts of dosages that can cause serious psychological damage, psychotic behaviour, very elevated temperature. There are no treatments. There's no equivalent of naxalone, for example, which counteracts the effects of a heroin overdose, because naxalone goes into the receptors and kicks out the heroin so it can get it out of your system. There's nothing that we know of at the moment that can do that for the NPS. The sufferer basically has to be administered a general anaesthetic while attempts are made to reduce their body temperature. And he also described how people took cocktails, for example, people taking NPS with alcohol in the hope that they could actually drink more. And so they're also getting the effects of very serious alcohol consumption as well. Dr. Hazel Torrance of Glasgow University's Forensic Toxicology Department described some of the screening tests which are currently available. But even where screening tests are available for these uncontrolled drugs, they are not included in the drug-related death statistics. Barry James from Police Scotland's Forensic Department, I think Graham Day referred to this, described how psychoactive substances can be detected in the laboratory using mass spectrometry, and more recently nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. I was a bit concerned, however, to learn from him that the NMR machine that they have, a very large and expensive piece of kit, is there, but unfortunately isn't being used because there's a lack of trained personnel. And I've also heard that apparently there's quite a backlog of specimens awaiting analysis at the forensic department. Many of the techniques used to determine the structure and function of these very large and complex molecules are very specialised. But it did strike me there is a lot of expertise in our academic institutions, not just in Scotland, but across the UK and across the world, because this is a global problem. NPS act by attachment to receptors in the brain. Now, how they do so is very complicated, but comparisons of the chemical structures of substances which exhibit similar effects could lead to a better understanding of which functional groups and the sorts of shapes of molecules which could interact with the brain in this way. And I feel that there will be other spectroscopic techniques which could assist. And I wonder to what extent chemists and biochemists in academic laboratories are being encouraged to undertake research on these topics. I think there is a lot of expertise out there, and if we actually understand the functioning of these better, we would not only be better able to detect what might be psychoactive and get a better handle on that, we also might be able to create substances which could work like naloxone and actually kick the things out the receptors. So it's very, as complete serendipity, but the Cross-Party on Science and Technology is meeting with the Medical Research Council tonight, and they're giving us a presentation on the value of and impact of medical research in Scotland. Now, the MRC is one of the major funders of scientific research in Scotland and across the UK, so I hope I'll get the opportunity to raise this issue of whether or not there is biochemical and chemical research into NPS and the functionality and detection actually being done in our academic institutions, because if there isn't, that's an area which could well be funded. Helpfully. Graham Pearson mentioned the issue about trading standards, and we spoke about this at topical questions today, because there are problems in trading standards, not just in Scotland. I think in England the situation is even worse. And trading standards are going to have to be resourced and quite possibly restructured in order to be able to undertake these additional responsibilities. And I wonder if the Scottish Government is aware of any financial resource attached to the UK Government's bill which would enable trading standards departments to carry out this additional and extremely important work, because I think there should be. Many colleagues talked about the need for education. Richard Simpson said that people have always sought substance which causes a high. That's true, actually, that always has been the case, whether it's alcohol, whether it's legal, whether it's illegal substances. And I think we need to appreciate that and understand that. And I was, finally, I was very interested in the contribution. Both Margaret Mitchell and Christine Graham referred to this as to whether prosecution could take place already under common law as culpable and reckless conduct. And indeed, in that case, Christine Graham reminded us that it was 20, 30 years ago. It was glue sniffing that was the problem that we were worried about. So we're moving on from that. And is there an opportunity there? So I think there's a number of issues where there may be opportunities for further discussion and further in different fields. There's a capability of further discussion which might lead us further forward in the fight against these substances.
Thank you so much. I now call on Paul Wheelhouse, Minister. You have until 5 o'clock. Many thanks.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm very grateful for the opportunity to reflect on today's debate this afternoon. As I alluded to in my opening comments, I've not been disappointed by the quality and collaborative contributions from members across the political divide. If I may say so, I think today's debate shows our Parliament in extremely good light in terms of taking what is a very serious issue in a matter that's bipartisan, and with appropriate forethought, very well thought through speeches by all concerned. I'm very grateful to parties across the chamber for their support for the government's work. I'm looking forward to working with you in due course as we go forward, and particularly thank Alex Johnson and Alison McInnes for very kind remarks about myself. But members have reflected on a number of areas today, and I'll try and do justice to them. There are a few areas of public policy perhaps that bring us together in the way that NPS has done today. Members have reflected on the devastation these substances can cause, indeed the shock that sometimes we experience in terms of the effects they have. Graham Day, Alex Johnson, Elaine Murray, Alison McInnes picked up on some very specific points that raised at the ministerial working group. Members have reflected on a number of constituency issues where this is a serious cause for concern for parents. I was particularly struck by the examples given by Margaret Mitchell, young Jamie Donnelly, and indeed David Lewis and Christine Graham's constituency. The tragic loss of young lives really brings it to a focus. At a local level, clearly I picked the point up that Sarah Boyack made, that we need to have a balance between national and local approaches, and I will touch on the resourcing issue that's been raised by a number of members in a second. But as has been reflected, NPS is not just the drug of choice of rebellious young people. Far from it. It's naturally people will be drawn to risky behaviour. But NPS is being used by older and more established drug users. And when I visited Crewe, I heard that very experienced drug users are often terrified by the impact it's had on them. And they've been used to taking perhaps similar volume of a illicit drug, taking NPS equivalent, and finding it far stronger than they had expected. And the medical effects quite pronounced. I think the challenge of in response is going to have to reflect the complexity of the issue. And despite our desires, politicians, to find quick fixes and easy solutions, I think we all know there isn't one in this case. So even bringing NPS under legal control will not be the full answer. Elaine Murray reflected that. Dr. Richard Simpson reflected on that. That we do have, and I do have to acknowledge the points that were made. Even if I don't agree with everything that was said, I do acknowledge the spirit of what Dr. Simpson was saying about the need to look to control sales that go into the dark internet and other options as well. Now, Graham Pearson, I think, was the first to pick up on the injecting trend. That's something that we are very worried about in certain locations, and I think he's right to raise that. And indeed, Graham Pearson and other members refer to poly drug use, and that is clearly a fact that we have to take into consideration. A combination of whether it's alcohol or other illicit drugs and NPS is posing a real risk to people. And we need to make them aware of the risks through education, clearly. Margaret Mitchell referred to dosage variability and the availability of drugs being, or NPS being a key consideration locally and indeed nationally. Kevin Stewart quite rightly referred to the criticisms of using legal highs as a terminology and the difficulty, I suppose, in finding an alternative that works for the young people that we're trying to engage with and in terms that they understand and also not give false legitimacy to the use of NPS. Dr. Simpson, apart from raising the issue of the dark side websites, I think also pointed out very fairly that people are engaging effectively in phase one trials of substances. We have no idea what impact they're going to have on them, and that's clearly a message we have to get out there. Turning to trading standards, just to point out, I appreciate the wider picture of trading standards that may have been debated today, and I didn't hear the responses to that, but just to point out that we have provided some funding, appreciate limited, but some funding to Trading Standards Scotland in assisting in implementation of the guidance that we have launched a couple of weeks ago. We do recognise the pressures in trading standards, and this funding will assist in gathering a local picture in each authority on NPS availability and the number of head shops. The funding will also be used to help fund forensic identification where that's necessary to identify the substances being sold. It's modest, it's in the region of £30,000, but hopefully it will help address a specific issue. Kevin Stewart also referred to the NPS expert review group and the potential for using a licensing approach similar to New Zealand. The expert review group did conclude that there was a real risk that in doing so, having looked at the New Zealand example, that the licensing, the sale of NPS would be seen as a way of endorsing the products and confirming their safe to use. So hence the approach that we have taken. But I think he very fairly went on to talk about the need to do more in terms of looking at the role of education and indeed just to confirm the next theme to be discussed by the NPS Ministerial Cross-Party Working Group will be around education. I'd like to take the point of guidance for schools to this meeting to pick up on the point he referred to. Graham Day talked very fairly about tailoring the messages for user groups and understanding the different motivations for purchasing by different groups. And I think the research we have commissioned will help us understand better the nature of the demand from different groups, whether it's older users or younger users, and hopefully help those involved in the advisory scene to help tailor the messages. And obviously the work we're doing with Education Scotland can pick up on that as well. Alison McInnes, I'm sorry I don't have time, Ms Graham, but I will come on to the point that you have raised, I can assure you. In terms of displacement risk, I think Alison McInnes referred to that, and it's a very important point. We do have to understand the longer-term issues are largely unknown as well. That's a fair point that Ms McInnes made. And the manifestations of poisoning and the identification of mental health risks are also very well-made points. In terms of the police and Crown use of the common law, the point that Christine Graham raised, just to assure Christine Graham and other members that the police and partners are committed to tackling NPS and using the powers available to them, including culpable and reckless behaviour, until the new legislation comes into effect in April 2016. There are a number of cases pending, these are with the Procurator Fiscal. I do appreciate that there is a lot of interest in the Chamber in seeing whether those are successful, and clearly we have to judge the independence of the Lord Advocate and the Crown in taking forward cases, but I will make the Chamber's views known to the Lord Advocate in due course. Sarah Boyack also mentioned, as did Richard Simpson, the Wedynos project in Wales. And I hope members are reassured that that is featured in the consultation that we have launched recently to look at how we can share information across the UK. And also we have been studying the work of the Welsh Government in terms of the Wedynos project to learn any lessons there. So I can reassure them on that. And Nigel Dawn mentioned the Forfar petition, and it shows people power having an impact in Forfar. As he rightly said, though, there are still head shops within the near vicinity, and so the problem has not been solved. But I do recognise and welcome the contribution that Alex Johnson and Nigel Dawn drew attention to of the local community, taking this issue, grabbing it by the horns and tackling it. John Finney talked about education. I very much agree with him about the importance of education in this whole debate. I think he referred to having a message around don't do it and why don't do it, to sort of look at the reasons why people shouldn't do it. I would go further than that. The young people on Saturday were saying, and it's potentially controversial, but if you are going to do it, be aware of the risks in doing it. So I think we have to listen to the messages that will resonate with them and tailor the message for that audience. And maybe that message, a different message might work for an older audience, but I do take his point on board. Roderick Campbell also referred to the importance of education and the impossibility of telling the contents. He is absolutely right in a product. We have to get that message across that people buying something that looks quasi-legitimate in a packet, it may not be safe. The variability of the product between one packet and another, even where the branding is the same, can be very significant, and therefore they may accidentally overdose. So just to close, Presiding Officer, I would just like to reiterate my personal thanks to all of the members across the Chamber for their support in this debate and their work, support in the work of the cross-party ministerial group that I'm leading. And I look forward to continuing the engagement with members across the Chamber and working with the Home Office to deliver the legislation at UK level. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on progress in implementing recommendations of the expert review group and new psychoactive substances. We now move on to the next item of business, which is decision time. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion number 14375, in the name of Stuart Stevenson, on the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament Amendment Bill, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14403, in the name of Paul Wheelhouse, on the progress on implementing recommendations of the expert review group in new psychoactive substances be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We are now moving to members' business. Members who are leaving the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.